I think it's like a different world out here.
Rivers, streams, mountains, you know, just everything. It's neat to experience it through baseball.
I'm gonna groove one right here. Right there. Nice, nice. That a boy. Get going. Get going. Get going. Get going. Get going. Nice. That a boy.
Good. Real good.
That a boy, Rocky.
Look at three, Rock. Look at three.
This is probably the most unique place a 19-20-year-old to spend a summer.
You get 70 to 80 degrees, no humidity. It's perfect baseball weather.
The scenery's a little different than Kansas, you know, that's the main thing that I've noticed.
Just the all-around package of it up here, just, it's a dream come true.
There's a quality of life up here I really, really appreciate. And then the golfing and fishing, of course.
From the producers of Touching the Game, the story of the Cape Cod Baseball League, comes a new film that gives an inside look at a place where they only play day games.
I think the first 5 days, I got about 15 hours of sleep.
We'd stay up to about 2:30 in the morning fishing, and still just that evening light out there.
I didn't know if I was going to be able to go to sleep or what, and we're going to be playing like midnight games and everything like that, but I like it now.
The Alaska Baseball League. Our award-winning documentary crew immerse themselves in the heart of the frontier state, in a league that is rich in baseball history. And a vacation destination for any true baseball fan.
Every baseball fan should come up and watch the Midnight Sun game. Just to see the atmosphere and what it's like to start a baseball game at 10:30 at night and not have to use artificial lights.
It's a league where lasting bonds are formed, and there is no shortage of knowledgeable and colorful characters.
People here are great. They love their baseball, and they love this league. They come out and they put their heart and soul in it. They really have a good time out here.
And everybody has a story to tell.
This moose is running as fast as it can straight towards me.
They grow these 100-pound cabbages and things.
Bear comes up right behind us. I'm like, what the heck's going on?
And I thought, oh, holy cow, this guy is going to crash. He veered off and missed the scoreboard by, I don't know how he missed the scoreboard, but he missed the scoreboard.
It's a starting ground for future stars, where long road trips can be a grueling but unforgettable experience.
Base hit right here, bingo.
Bingo hall? You know, I'm staying in cots. But man, you get up there and you got all your team together and you guys are together that whole weekend. It's a blast.
You seriously go through some funny things in there. You create situations that you can talk about years from now and say, hey, remember when this happened, remember when that happened.
The Olympic Village is definitely something you don't really talk about until you kind of had that experience.
It's bad, but like it's a funny bad. Yeah, you just go there, you stay there. It makes you want to be out on the field to play baseball.
It's a place where boys become men, and some of the best amateur baseball in the world is played.
There's no experience like summer in Alaska.
It's there to beat you down. It's there to test you as a human being. And you know, just as life is going to throw some tough things at you, it's going to prepare you for pretty much anything you're going to face in this game. It's just overcoming adversity and can you mentally handle it? And if you can, you're going to get pretty far in this game.
Touching the Game, Alaska.
The path to success in a changing economy has its share of ups and downs. That's why 49th State Brewing Company partners Jason and David came to First National Bank Alaska, where experience matters, local knowledge counts, and understanding Alaska's many frontiers makes all the difference. From Denali Park to downtown Anchorage, we can help you succeed. First National Bank Alaska. We believe in Alaska.
Today at BP, we're keeping oil and gas flowing where and when it's needed.
So we're going to be driving.
And increasing investment in the transition to lower carbon energy. Right now, we're driving 46,000 steel beams into the ground for a new solar project that will drive lower carbon energy and support local jobs. Our team has recently expanded our production of renewable diesel, which is expanding its use across the West Coast. Our engineers just connected 12 new wells to an existing platform, connecting the country to more oil and gas at a critical time. We're running more wells on electricity so we can run our operations with lower emissions. Just some of the ways we're turning our plans into action. And BP's wider transformation is underway. While today we're mostly in oil and gas, we've increased global investment into our lower carbon and other transition businesses from around 3% in 2019 to around 30% last year.
In 1986, we started the Alaskan Brewing Company. And so we've always tried to reflect the quality that the state has in the beers that we make.
Alaska's beautiful. It's true. It's real.
For 30 years, we've been trying to capture the nature of Alaska and put it in a bottle. Today, 30 years later, we're still making beer in the last frontier.
I think you're going to like your new nose, Miss Hastings.
And cut!
I'm Steve Martin.
As an actor, it's my job to make people believe that what they're seeing is real.
Ha! Hey!
That the frustration is real. Man, I'm hungry.
Oh,
the disappointment is real.
1, 2, 3, 4! Winner!
Eat it, Kyle. You're all losers. That the joy is real, but it's not real. It's acting.
Wow! That's fantastic!
Or was I just acting? Only way to find out is to try it yourself.
We are a family business serving Alaskans for over 60 years. Our founder is my dad, Herb Ekman, a German immigrant who started the business in 1963 with his good friend, Otto. To this day, the business is dedicating to making products that are distinctive and of the highest quality.
Jace Andrews alongside Drake Toll, and the Bucs taking on the Oilers after a very crazy doubleheader. Sponsored by Bing.
Yeah, why not? Whoa, dude. Talk about crazy doubleheaders yesterday. It was the first sudden death victory by an organized sports team in history. The very first ever sudden death victory in any game, and the Bucs got it right here from Coral Gables Park. Look, two crazy, crazy games. A 2-1 win, and then a walk-off sudden death win. Bases loaded, ball four, and the Bucs have a 2-1 series lead. They can clinch this whole thing tonight. I say why not with Sky Wells on the mound.
Yeah, you got one of your best pitchers, but before that, we'll talk to the walk-off winner, Alex Pendergast, in the Full Sail pregame show. That coming up here on the Anchorage Bucs Baseball Network.
If there's one thing I've learned at Speedy Glass, it's that every chip becomes a crack. Today, I'm going to show you why. When we look at a chip up close, we see tons of tiny cracks that are just waiting to spread. Don't wait for your chip to crack. Repair it at Speedy Glass before having to replace the entire windshield. You'll save time. You'll be back on the road within an hour. Book an appointment at speedyglass.ca.
Speedy Glass Repair. Speedy Glass Replace.
An alert from Wells Fargo, $107 at Doggy Lover's Warehouse. No, I would never.
Doggy Lover's, please.
You know me. I don't even know where that is. Look, I'm replying deny.
See?
Oh, come on. Hello? Wells Fargo, I did not make that purchase. I didn't do it! I'm so glad you caught that. Uh-huh.
Welcome back to the Full Sail pregame show. Jace Andrews alongside the walk-off winner, Alex Pendergast.
I just want to first give you a chance to kind of describe what you were feeling going up to that bat, bases loaded, now two outs.
I was just trying to find a way to first base. That's really, it was the last at bat of the game no matter what, and I just made it a normal at bat, find a way to first. It's how you do it every at bat, so I didn't try to change anything and didn't really get anything competitive in the zone, so it worked out for me.
I think you can see the team's camaraderie come together, especially last night. Everybody was on the top step, and I think the excitement really got you. How do you think this team is coming together as a whole about now third through the season?
Yeah, I think this Kenai trip is huge. I feel like all of us staying in the bingo hall, getting to spend a lot of extra time together off the field is really good for the team bonding. And I've heard it usually happens at the end of the season. It's really unfortunate when that happens because it is a huge bonding experience. So I think it's huge for us to get it this early in the season and then go back to Anchorage and have the rest of the season with this bonding experience under our belt.
You mentioned bingo hall. Who's the best bingo player?
Honestly, we've only gotten to play once. I can tell you the worst is Blake Lobel because he missed a bingo. I don't know who the best is, but I can tell you he is the worst.
You've gotten to play baseball in a lot of different states. Iowa, you played last summer with the CPL in North Carolina. You've gotten to play now with DBU. How does Alaska compare to all those?
It's a lot harder to hit in. The ball doesn't carry here as much as it does down in the lower 48. So it's challenging, but it's a different experience, and it's something that I'm not going to probably be able to do again in my career. So I'm here to embrace the challenge and look forward to going to work for it the rest of the summer.
You're one of the few guys that has multiple teammates on this team, and not only do you have a couple of DBU guys, you got a Kirkwood Community College guy, Trenton Burkhalter, here. Yeah. Is it nice kind of to get to have already known a couple of players?
Oh, yeah, it was great coming in knowing three different guys. The first night I was here, I got to hang out with Trent, and then obviously Joey and Cade from this year at DBU, and it just made the process a lot easier getting to know guys because you have people to introduce you. So it made it a lot more easier and less stressful than it's been in the past.
I mentioned we're a third through the season. What, to this point, has been your f***ing a buck?
I would say the looseness of the team. I think nobody really overplays anything, and everybody's here just to kind of have fun, and it's not really tense. It's really relaxed, really laid back, and that's fun baseball, and that's the type of baseball that I like to play, so that's probably been my favorite part so far.
And then one last question, as Burkhalter is kind of giving you a little crud during this interview, is it kind of nice to have almost a like brother-like feel with a couple of these guys already?
Yeah, it is. Trent's kind of like my little brother. I picked him up and raised him at Kirkwood because he was the younger guy, and it's funny to see how far he's come since then, and it is a good time.
And then one last question, I have to mention it. You developed a nickname on the broadcast of Eve's boyfriend. Anything you'd like to say to that?
I think it's hilarious. She thinks it's hilarious. She feels like the team girlfriend now, so it's pretty funny, and I mean, you guys do whatever you want up there. Have fun. Have your fun.
All right, thank you. We'll be right back here. That was Alex Pendergast in the Full Sail pregame show. Appreciate it, man.
Man, valet took forever.
There's no valet here.
Who took my That could have been bad.
Do the do. Welcome to today's side quest. The store run against the clock. Just another day in the life of Mike. Lemonade that hits harder for mics that go harder. The world needs more mics.
It was time to update the bathroom.
But we didn't want to break the bank.
Rebath made it effortless. A Rebath design consultant came to our home and presented us ideas and products in a way that made our decisions simple.
They took away the old, installed the new, and gave us the bathroom
we've always wanted.
Style affordably. Call 1-844-9-REBATH for your free in-home design consultation today.
Of all the reasons we love Alaska, easy isn't one of them. We like a good challenge, but we also love innovative technology that simplifies our busy lives. Whether you want to make a deposit or pay a bill, check in or check out, or quickly send and receive money, One Bank has the online and mobile tools to help you through whatever comes your way. Simple, secure, reliable. Bank on the go. First National Bank, Alaska.
Arby's new Steakhouse Garlic Ribeye Sandwich. Who knew the best thing to come from a steakhouse wouldn't even come from a steakhouse? Arby's did, that's who. Arby's, we have the meat.
Welcome back to Coral Seymour Stadium. Jace Andrews joined by Drake Toll. Let's get to the starting lineup for your Anchorage Bucs. Batting lead off, the designated hitter, Cade Lacey out of Phoenix College. Batting second, the UC Irvine's Miles Smith. Batting third, the third baseman, Jackson Sorensen, who is now committed to Iowa Western to play his baseball next year. In the cleanup slot, it's Zach Thomas out of LSU Eunice. Batting fifth, the second baseman, Alex Pendergast out of Dallas Baptist University. Batting sixth, the left fielder, Lex Bodinger from the University of Central Florida. Batting seventh, the catcher, Trenton Burkhalter out of Nebraska, Omaha. Batting eighth, the shortstop, Logan Hocuff. And batting ninth, out of San Diego, Ben Haar. The defense for the Oilers go as followed. Rada at first, Groupie at second, Forshe at third, Elko at short. The outfield from left to right, Drewby Pinkston, Nick Costello, and Ben Griffin in right. And the battery, Josiah Chavez behind the plate for Ryan Palmer, who's on the mound. And Drake, what can you tell us about Ryan Palmer as we have a little dance party?
Jace, Ryan Palmer, 6'3", 210-pound freshman from California Baptist University. He's a Lancer. He's 1-0 in the ABL, has a 9 ERA, which is one earned run per inning.
Leading off for the Bucs,
as he has pitched
Cade
11
Lacey.
Innings and allowed 11 earned runs. He started in one game, just his second start here, has played four total, 11 innings pitched, 17 strikeouts, 9 walks, 13 hits.
Cade Lacey will be the first one to greet him as New York now underway at Coral Seymour Stadium. A ball taken by Lacey, and it's 1-0.
Should mention as well, Ken Hocuff will not be coaching for the Bucs tonight due to an ejection yesterday. So Kenny Barton and Bishop Griggs will take the reins.
Swing and a miss there from Cade Lacey. Bucs come in here with a .261 team average. That's second in the ABL. Oilers with a .971 fielding percentage, which is second. Lacey inside fastball. He has to bend out of the way.
Oiler fans are already a little eccentric today.
Yeah, they were very eccentric pretty much both games yesterday.
Yep, they were.
2-1 from Ryan Palmer. Strike taken.
I don't know about that.
It's the same pitch we saw last night.
It's a different home plate umpire.
That's where the problem comes in. Two balls and two strikes to Cade Lacey. Gets it to the left side. Diving stop by the third baseman. Forshe across the diamond to first is in time.
Really
nice
good play.
Play.
Really good play from Forshe. That ball, I mean, just complete layout. You can see the dirt all over his jersey, and he's still able to make the throw and get the out.
Now batting the childhood actor, Miles Smith. He's also an on-base machine and a speedster.
Wait a second. That's the same home plate umpire that called the strike three beneath the knee of Jacob Rebrook, if I remember correctly.
That's what I had the inclination of that,
to
but I don't want to say anything.
To end the Bucs game, yeah. All right, we know this guy. I tell you what, he won't hear a word out of Ken Hocuff tonight.
Yeah, because he's not here.
Oh, thanks. Thanks for, yeah, that was the part.
That was the
yeah,
joke.
That was the punchline.
Fouled off on the 1-0 by
Smith. Ball brought to you by Christy Babcock State Farm.
Smith, good at baseball, was solid last night in game two of the doubleheader. Reached base three times, couple base hits. Four times, couple base hits, couple walks.
Yeah, he's got a .285 average, which is 24th in the ABL. Yeah.
Ball brought to you by the Kenai Little League.
In 14 at-bats, has four hits, has scored three runs, has three walks, four strikeouts.
One ball, two strikes. The Smith. Again, launch foul.
Foul ball brought to you by Joseph
Smith. Had
a
tough game yesterday in game one as well, so seeing him really come through clutch in game two was nice. He was one of the Bucs on board when they had him loaded in sudden death.
1-2. outside. Yeah, that was an interesting call there by the Oilers to load the bases.
Well, I get it. A man on first with only one out. You load him up, then you get a strike out of Jackson Sorensen, and then a four-pitch walk just wasn't competitive.
2-2. That's low and through the legs of the catcher, Chavez, and it's full now.
3-2 count. Smith, one of the best of them in this roster at seeing pitches.
Full count pitch from Ryan Palmer. That'll be lined into right field. Griffin goes back on it. It's going to hit the base of the wall. Smith rounding first, heading for two, and he starts his evening off with a double. Miles Smith already a buck in scoring position, and we're not two batters into the game.
Miles Smith getting it going, and here's what I like about that. Oh, look, great piece of hitting on a 3-2. But really what got me fired up about it is the dugout's reaction. These guys are bought in. They know their coaching staff really values them and will go to fight and battle for them. That's half of it here in Summer League Baseball. And they love each other, man. These dudes just love being together. That's what this Kenai trip is all about. I like that the dugout's getting up early.
First pitch to Sorensen is inside. And with the ejection of Hocuff, we also have yet to mention, guess who's the first base coach tonight?
Mike Sarhat, baby. I said, look, Mike, I saw him in the bathroom. He was in the right urinal. I was on the left. I said, Mike, there is no sending guys off of first base on sack flies to right field tonight. And Mike denies ever being part of anything that has occurred that would be similar to that.
We have tape.
Yes, we do. In a game, the Bucs lost by one, by the way.
Yeah. Two balls and no strikes to Sorensen. Bucks leader in average at 365. Smith takes off. It's a hit and run. Throw it down to third. Smith is out to dry.
Yep.
Hit and run. Sorensen unable to make contact. And Miles Smith is thrown out as he's caught stealing. There's two outs now.
I think Smith got a late jump on it. It wasn't close at third base. He was out by a good amount.
Two balls and one strike now to Sorensen. Palmer still going from the stretch, even though nobody on. Maybe not realize that nobody's there yet.
We talked to Bob from the ESPN radio crew up here in Kenai, ESPN Kenai Peninsula, 11:40 a.m. And he said, don't ever play the what-if game in a baseball game. But what if?
Yeah, guy, second base. Lifted in the air, foul territory on the third base side. It's the third baseman, Forshea. He makes the grab. Well, the Bucks only end up sending three to the plate as Miles Smith is caught stealing, trying for third. We'll go to the bottom of the first, 0-0 on the Anchorage Bucs Baseball Network.
Arby's new Steakhouse Garlic Ribeye Sandwich.
Of all the reasons we love Alaska, easy isn't one of them. We like a good challenge, but we also love innovative technology that simplifies our busy lives. Whether you want to make a
night an experience worth savoring. New Boar's Head Firesmith Flame Grilled Chicken Breast. Flavor forged in flame. Available only at the deli and only from Boar's Head. Compromise elsewhere.
Welcome back here to Coral Seymour Stadium. Scoop has entered the field of play, the mascot for the Peninsula Oilers. Let's get to the starting lineup for the home team, Peninsula Oilers. They come in here with the fourth best average in the Alaska Baseball League at 236. Leading off will be the DH, Owen McElfetrick, batting second to left fielder Drewby Pinkston, batting third out of Cal State Northridge, Ben Griffin. Cleanup, Nick Costello out of UC San Diego, batting left field, Forshea, batting sixth for catcher Josiah Chavez. Batting seventh, the first baseman Michael Rod out of Cal Baptist, and batting eighth, the shortstop Michael Elk out of Northwestern. And the ninth slot is the second baseman Brett Groupie out of the University of Central Missouri. On the mound tonight for your Bucks, Sky Wells. First pitch is fly to right field. And Boedeker, who's playing right field tonight, makes the grab. One pitch, one out for Sky Wells. The fielding alignment for your Anchorage Bucks at first base, Zach Thomas. Second base, Alex Pendergast. At third base, Jackson Sorensen. Playing short is Logan Hocuff. The outfield from left to right, Ben Hall, Miles Smith, and Boedeker, who just made the first out. The battery, as I mentioned, Tritton Burkhalter catching for Sky Wells, who's making Drake. As the ball is outside.
Making his third start in the ABL in four games where he's appeared. He's got a 1-0 record, a 3.48 ERA. The Bucs are 2-1 when Sky Wells enters a ball game for the team. He has gone a total of 10 and a third, 16 strikeouts, 7 walks. 5 of those walks, though, coming in his last appearance at Mat-Su.
A little blooper, it's right to Burkhalter. There you go, 2 outs.
Well, you know, we've talked about it a lot. Bunting in this league struggles. We've seen so many guys bunt it right up to the catcher, the pitcher, or somebody else. I'll tell you, though, Sky Wells is working on recovering from that game against the Miners, where he went only 1 1/3 in a start in Mat-Su, 4 earned runs, 5 walks. Didn't allow a hit, but 4 earned runs because the control wasn't there. He's trying to come back from that tonight.
First pitch of the new batter, Ben Griffin, is taken upstairs for a ball. Griffin batting .326. He had a homer in the first game of this series back on, what was that, Wednesday?
December
Tuesday?
28th.
Whatever that was, I don't know. Strike one on the foul
been
tip.
Been years since that game.
I think you were 16 when that game happened.
Yeah, something like that.
One ball and one strike to the left fielder. On the third baseline, it's foul. Sorensen taking a new position over at third. First time we've seen him there.
Not the first time, but good to see him over there. Sorensen's played a little bit. He's played third a couple times. Maybe not when you were here. I'll give you that. Also, Sky Wells is still in the top 10 in strikeouts in the league. He's got 16 of those this season. Could add 17 here.
1-2 from the lefty. Skied into center field. Gas as it just reaches the outfield grass. He makes the grab, and Sky Wells works a clean 1-2-3, bottom of the first. Second inning coming up on the Anchorage Bucs Baseball Network.
Who knew the best thing to come from a steakhouse wouldn't even come from a steakhouse? Arby's did, that's who. Arby's, we have the meat.
Subway has so much new, I couldn't fit it all in the last ad.
Yep, so let me finish this. There's new hickory smoked bacon, fresh mozzarella, smashed avocado. You know what? There's a lot. But it all makes a better footlong.
Can I get a word in?
Sure. Take the tagline.
Because
you gotta refresh to be fresh.
It's the Eat Fresh Refresh at Subway. And they're refreshing everything from how they make it to how they bake it to how they bring it to you.
This new Turkey Cali Fresh is incredible.
Do you even eat bread?
Steph, it's a commercial.
Psst. Hey, Jake from State Farm. I want that personal price plan. So how's this for personal? I draw mustaches on players' faces when they're asleep.
Coach Reed, you don't need to get that personal to get the State Farm personal price plan. It helps you create an affordable price just for you.
Oh.
Coach, it happened again.
I'm gonna get to the bottom of this.
Call or click to get a quote today. Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there.
All right, so the microphones were not on for that entire half inning, and there was nobody to tell me. So you want to recap what we just saw here? We won't go to commercial break. We'll just bring it right back. Okay. Ah, yes. Oh, Angie, yeah. Now that was... So, okay. Strikeout.
Okay.
Strikeout.
I got the stat.
Zach
Thomas came up. It was a five-pitch strikeout swing. Pendergast came up, two pits, ground out to the second base.
Okay.
Then Lex Butterker came up, but before then, the mics were off. There was a discussion going on the field.
Yes.
The Oilers head coach came out, talked to the home plate umpire. Home plate umpire got the umpiring crew together, then proceeded to go talk to the Bucs dugout. Bishop Griggs came over, gave a message to the dugout. We can only assume it was due to chirping, whatever going on. Everything was fine. Butterker worked a thin five-pitch walk to get to first base. And then Burkhalter popped out into foul territory to the first baseman. I think I got it all, right?
I think you got it all.
Okay.
So the conversation, the biggest mainstay there in the top of the second was a conversation between the umpires and the dugout. And it looked like the staff, this is a guess for sure, but the way this series has gone, these two dugouts have chirped one another mightily. There's been some jawing here. None of it gone too far at all, but these two teams have got moxie to them, we'll put it that way. And the fans do too. You've heard the fans say some borderline mean stuff to the Bucs players, which, look, like I said, our microphones were off. If you can't take a fan telling you to swing the bat in the Alaska Baseball League, you're going to hate the MLB. So I love that the fans get that involved. It's a great part of baseball when crowds are engaged, right? So, yeah, we got an update from the dugout. Players have been told they cannot chirp at the Oilers at all. This is the second game in a row the players have been told that. Now, I was told some Oilers players said some things about a Bucs player's sister, but that's neither here nor there. That's been the nature of this series here on the Peninsula. These two teams going back and forth, John. And that's a part of the game. That's a part of the game at every level.
Correct.
And then,
Oilers,
I guess...
Number 26, Nick. Costello!
The umpires are not the ones that talk to the Bucs.
No,
they're not
the
ones to put a stop to it. It was the Oilers coaching staff that said, we're tired of listening to these guys. Shut them up. And the umpires obliged.
Nick Costello will step up to the plate.
This is a league that's got a lot of teams with moxie. That's
it
the way does. We've seen this thing play out this year.
There's personality to every ball club here.
We have seen the Matsu team. I mean, pitcher just walking off the mound on a
screaming.
Show. Yeah, just yelling at the Bucs dugout.
0-1.
And I like that. You know, you were in the Coastal Plains League last year. I worked up on Cape, and you didn't see a lot of it. It was pretty traditional baseball, but this is how the game is played at the collegiate level. This is what it looks like.
I will say, there was a fight last year between my team and the Savannah Bananas.
Oh, wow.
That was odd. 1-1, lined hard into right field for a base hit.
First hit that Wells has given up in this game.
I'm going to bring up 304 Shea with a runner at first base.
Talk about Wells. He is going to make use of that mound being as tall as it is. That is,
not
that
bad,
is
number
a
17, Theo
really
Shea.
Good thing if you're Sky Wells, who couldn't get a good jump off the mound at Matsu.
Yeah, this mound helps him out a lot. He's a lot taller, which is something that he didn't really have at Matsu. It was a very flat level mound. Couldn't get down with his front foot. Forshay with a 285 average. Watches the first pitch for a strike.
They missed the whole part about how building your city on rock and roll is structurally unsound, because I really stand by
really
that.
Really forgot that.
I really hope that went through the airwaves.
No one. Inside pitch.
It's an engineering nightmare. Forshey batting 286 this season. 2-for-7. This is his first series in Alaska.
1-1 with the runner at first. It's up high.
The sun has come out today.
Yeah, we
got a little bit of that.
Mentioned that
as well. The first time in a while. We did talk about that.
I think the first time ever, to be honest, at least in Kenai.
First spout of sun that I've seen up here.
Throw over is not in time, up and standing.
We went on a 3,000 foot hike today. Saw a mountain.
Yeah. Well, I think we were on the mountain.
Woke up at 7:30 to do it.
2-1.
lifted foul.
The things you do in Alaska, right? We went, walked, we eclipsed a 3,000-foot mountain, saw some snow, enjoyed a very long hike from 8:30 to about, what, 1 o'clock?
Yeah, 1, 1:30.
And then went and ate reindeer sausage sandwiches. Yeah. And now we're at a baseball game. The beauty of the ABL, huh?
2-2. Bounced up the middle. Hokuf. Flip to Pendergast. He loses the ball before he gets it. Unable to corral it. Was never able to get it to second base. It'll be a E6, and there's runners at first and second.
Now batting number 14, Josiah Chavez.
Josiah Chavez steps up. Thus far, a 214 average in the Alaska Baseball League. And I think the craziest part of that story is during the entire hike, we were just yelling out, "Hey, Bear."
Hey, Bear.
To make sure the Bears knew we were there.
That's what you're supposed to do. Great pitch from Sky Wells. That was a strike. You know, for Hokuf defensively at short, it's tough. It's for the adjust. We haven't talked about this much. There was an Arizona State prospect who was going to come help split time at shortstop alongside Hokuf. And said prospect ended up getting called up to play baseball for USA, for Team USA. So at that point, it was, all right, Logan Hokuf, this is your show. I mean, we had two shortstops slated to come up here. So that's a tough adjustment when the spotlight now completely becomes on you at shortstop. When you thought, all right, I've got a guy who I'm going to share split time with. There's somebody else coming here. But no, Logan Hokuf is the shortstop of this Anchorage Bucs team. A lot of pressure.
Putting the bunt down as Chavez. He gets it out in front of the mound. Burkhalter out. Throw to Pendergast at first in time. Nice job by Burkhalter and Pendergast, the two Kirkwood College, Community College former teammates, combining for the first out of the inning. Runners do move up to second and third.
Close play at first base, but umpire and crew got the call right.
Now batting number 11, Michael Rada.
Rada up to the plate. Got runners at second and third. Bucks up. Strike at the plate.
Should mention to our eyes and ears in the dugout, Annika Morris. She is mentioned that there was not an official warning to either dugout. It was downgraded to just making the guys in the dugouts simmer down a bit.
Swinging strike from Rada. It's 0-2. Nothing to score here. And Skywell's trying to keep it that way. He's got an 0-2 count on Rada, trying to increase that strikeout total on the year. Oh, two. Pop foul.
Foul ball brought to you by Bill Parker.
Rada out of Cal Baptist University. Taking the first base roll this evening. Rada was the athlete of the year for the Canes national team. 0-2 after the foul ball. Spoils another one.
Wells says,
foul ball brought to you by Liz Dalton.
Lived in the strike zone. 16 strikes, 6 balls so far.
Skywell still with the 0-2 count to Michael Rada. Looks in and gets the sign from his catcher, Burkhalter. Deep breath, the 0-2. Up high. It's the fifth pitch of the AB, the sixth to come here on just a 1-2 count.
Yeah. Rod of the 7-hole, 14 strikeouts and 27 at-bats this year. Not great.
One, two. Outside. Two balls and two strikes.
Yeah. Good on Burkhalter to reach out and get that one.
Rada with a sub-200 average, but working a good AB here. Two balls and two strikes, the seventh pitch of the AB. As Scoop comes in, almost blocks the plate.
Excuse us, Scoop.
2-2's foul again.
Foul ball brought to you by the Smith Brothers.
Spoiling
long
multiple
AB,
pitches.
Yeah, still hasn't gotten to a full count.
It's going to be the eighth pitch coming up. And we're still at 2-2. One out in the inning. Sky Wells on the mound. Has won. Bucs have won the last two games he's appeared in.
Yeah.
And again, Rada putting together a good amount as he spoils another one.
Got down in a 4-0 hole. He came out against Matt Sue. Final score, Bucs 8, Miners 4 in that game. Probably the favorite game of the year for this team so far, getting that win on the road. Right up there with last night, the walk-off win in sudden death.
Guy steps off and he's going to have Burkhalter come out here.
Yeah, whoever's at second base right now is tipping the pitches. Yeah. It is Forche at second base who is tipping every pitch to the batter Rada, and he wasn't very sleek about it.
No, he was.
He wasn't very sleek at all. So
Wells turned around and saw a little hand movement there.
No pitch comm, so. They said, a lot of these guys said in summer ball, look, you can read pitches. You can read signal, you can read whatever you want to read. And that's
there's easy signals, right? I mean, right now, hand on his helmet, that could be a sign, you don't know. 2-2, up high. Now the ninth pitch of the AB coming, and it'll be a full count pitch finally.
Yeah.
Long AB here and from Rada.
The struggle in the middle of an at-bat, you're going to mix up signals. Change stuff around with Burkhalter, that's tough to do. Your Forche. One was your curveball, now your one is your slider.
Forche at second. And a 3-2 pitch coming to Rada. Just outside.
Yeah, that did not miss by much. I think Sky Wells wants that one back. Started the at-bat 0-2. And that looked pretty. That last pitch looked pretty. We've seen that goal strike in this league quite a bit.
Michael Elko steps up now with the bases loaded for the Oilers. And he actually hit a grand slam to help his high school team in 2021 to advance to the playoffs.
Walk-off?
Yep.
Walk
strike
off
at the plate.
Grand slam. Do we know what the score in the game was? Was it a...
I think it was one of those where it was like a one-run... I think it may have been tied, to be honest. They didn't list it, so I can only assume it wasn't...
Yeah.
It wasn't like they were down 3. 0-1.
Could be.
Big hack and a miss from Elko. 0-2.
All right. Strikeout here would be good. You got the force at home. Wells. 29 pitches now for through 1 1/3. That's not bad at all. I know I
won. 0-2. Nubbed off the end of the bat to Pendergast. Only able to get one. He'll get it. Run comes across to score. RBI to Michael Elko, and it's 1-0 Oilers.
Yeah, it just was not hit hard enough off the bat of Elko. Pendergast there in position, and slow roller on the infield puts the Oilers up 1-0. Huh. Joke's on them, though. The Anchorage Bucs love getting an early hole.
Oh, yeah. Makes their batters just have some kind of twang to the mathematics.
Little does Peninsula know, this is what the Oilers do. Or the Bucs, somebody.
The Bucs. 9 slot, Brett Groupe steps up. 190 batting average, runners at second and third. He swings the first pitch and fouls into the netting.
Base is loaded with only one out. One has already come across. Two down now. You can get out of this having only allowed one run. That's still a win, especially if Wells can stay under 35 pitches. He's at 31.
Rada at second base. Forche at third now. Brett Groupe at the plate out of the University of Central Missouri. Watches a fastball hide away. Bucs with a win today can take home the series as they'd get their third victory and make it, at worst, they're going 3-2 here in Kenai. 1-1. Just outside again. Nice frame job by Burkhalter, but definitely outside.
I think the ball's outside. It is. Not by much, but it is. Groupe batting 190. this season. Brett, the nine-hole hitter, 8 hits and 42 at-bats. He's an everyday guy for this Oilers team.
5'10", 175, a rising senior at the University of Central Missouri. 2-1. High in the infield. Pendergast calls everybody off and makes the play. Sky Wells only allows one Oiler to cross. A nice work by him to get out of the jam with minimal damage. Top of the third coming up. Bucs trying to come back now here on the Anchorage Bucs Baseball Network.
Keep on sunny side, always on sunny side.
Come into Village Inn and see why the sun rises and sets with breakfast.
It will help us every day, it will brighten all the way, if we keep on the sunny side of life.
Because a good meal is about more than just how it tastes. It's about how it makes you feel.
Keep on the sunny side, always on the sunny side. Keep on the sunny side of life.
Village Inn.
Qdoba's new Chicken Diablo Nachos are made with hand-diced pico de gallo, which means they're as fresh as... They're also loaded with juicy adobo chicken, flame-grilled in-house, so they're as flavorful as... And they're topped off with fiery queso Diablo, so they're as spicy as... New Chicken Diablo Nachos. Try them today, only at Qdoba. United by flavor.
Kenai, Alaska, Jace Andrews alongside Drake Toll here as the Bucs now down 1-0. It'll be 8-9-1 here in the top of the third against Ryan Palmer.
Number 17, Logan Hocuff.
Har and Lacy. If Hocuff and Har can each tally base hits today, the Bucs win. Calling it now.
First pitch to Hocuff. It's a strike. Strike number two on Hocuff. Ryan Palmer on the mound, 0-2 to Hocuff. That's outside, a little low as well. One ball, two strikes. It's Logan Hocuff. We're on the field without his dad tonight. Blooper, that'll drop into right field. Little Texas leaguer for Logan Hocuff. Takes a look at second. Ultimately settles with a single, a leadoff base knock for Logan Hocuff. Gets the Bucs going here in the top of the third.
Hey, hit number five this year for Hocuff. He's got a couple of those in this series for the Oilers. And now Hocuff stands at first base with nobody out. Ben Har to the plate.
And Har was a very key piece in that first game.
Also, Hocuff was at .083 a couple days ago. He's at .135 now.
He's really settling
in. He's had a good series up here in Kenai.
Well, and the best thing is his eye started to come about a week ago now. Started to see the ball started walking.
He really settled into the plate, it felt like.
First pitch to Har, a little low. And now the hits are starting to come as well. We saw that last night.
Call us right.
Har in the first game yesterday, I mean, he really, but him and Dante Turgeon, for all intents and purposes, won the game for the Bucs.
Yeah.
Because Ben Har nabbed a runner at home and had an RBI double. A little high there. 2-0.
So funny. So it was that pitch right there to Har that was about 3 or 4 inches below the knees. That's what got the Bucs.
Oh, yeah.
Rebrook at the plate a couple of games ago against the Glacier Pilots at home on the call that ended the game on Father's Day. It was so bad. And I loved it. Our friends, the broadcasters, it was against the Matsu Miners, actually. Our broadcast friends, the Matsu Miners, Austin and Jesse, they thought it was so good. He said, last pitch of the game goes, it's low and away, strike three.
Swinging a foul tip back in the catcher's mitt for him.
I'm going to have nightmares about that Father's Day game for the rest of my life.
It just stinks because, again, that's another one of those of these are two good teams having a great game.
100%.
And the umpire took the show away.
He's been a good zone tonight, though. He's done much better behind the plate.
2-1. Swing and a miss from Har, and it goes to
2-2. We usually get umpire names. I only got his, Aiden. We don't get first base and third base today.
2-2 Hokuf at first. Pop foul.
Separate ways by Jordy slash Steve Perry. I'm glad you put Bounce Steve Perry there. You got to be very specific. I want that to be your walk-up song, but Steve Perry's got to sing it.
That's fine.
No, no, no. That's what you want, right?
Yes.
Separate ways. Okay.
Yes.
You want Steve Perry.
That is what I want.
They tore without him.
2-2. Ben Har stays alive as he spoils that fastball. He was pretty on that pitch, but just back.
That. You're exactly right. That now brings Palmer's pitch count to 40.
I got a trivia question after this pitch for you.
Oh, do you? 22 strikes, 18 balls in just two innings.
Palmer shakes off the purse first, and now 2-2 coming. It's up high.
All right.
All right, here's your trivia question. There is a very famous Ryan, R-Y-N-E,
Howard.
That's Ryan Howard. There's a very famous Ryan. No, his is Ryan. R-Y-N-E. There's a very famous Ryan that played in the MLB. 3-2. Outside. Ben Har works the walk, and there's two on with nobody out.
100%. Nice eye from Ben Har. That ball was only about an inch, maybe two off the plate.
Cade
the same pitch
Lacy.
That got Sky Wells earlier and the only walk he dished out to Michael Rada. This has been so good.
I was just about to say.
The home plate umpire has been so good. We are very critical in this booth sometimes.
Correct.
About home plate umpires. And tonight, it has been good. So on the other side of it.
Sing the praises right now.
Give credit where credit is due.
This has been a very, very good zone.
Want to find the umpire hut after the game and shake his hand. Say thank you very much.
I want to shake your hand.
I want to shake your hand. He's that guy, pal. All right. Ryan.
R-Y-N-E.
I'm going to make sure. Ryan Howard.
It's Ryan.
Okay. Okay.
That's a W.
All right. There are a lot of Ryan Howards. The Ryan Howard I was referencing is apparently a WNBA player in Atlanta.
Ryan Howard played in the 1900s area. 1960s.
Ryan Howard?
Anybody in the chat? No, I bet the
baseball player of the Phillies, Ryan Howard. First base, big
Ryan.
Old guy. Yes.
Yes.
I thought it was spelled R-Y-N-E.
No, it's Ryan.
Okay. Give me Ryan Stanek.
No, I don't. He may be Ryan.
He might be Ryan.
I think he may be Ryan. I don't know. I don't know about that one. Runners at first and second for the leadoff slot. Cade Lacy, 0-1 today. Watches the first pitch as a strike.
Okay, all right. Now, we were all going on about how good he's
so
done
close.
Behind the plate, and that was and now he calls that a strike. He is a Ryan. He is a Ryan Stanek, R-Y-N-E.
Okay, that's one.
Former Arkansas Razorback.
How about a famouser one? More famous one.
Famouser. Pulled that one out of the hat, huh?
I like to pull them. Call them Jace-isms.
Jace-isms. That'd be a great one. That'd be a great way to get a job. A job interview, like, why'd you say it this way?
Jace-ism.
I do. All right, you're hired. All right, give it to me. Who's the famous Ryan?
Plays for the Cubs. Ryan Sandberg.
Okay. Relation to Andy?
I don't think so. 1-1. A little low.
Just a little.
Well, Ryan Palmer here. Cannot find the strike zone currently.
That's why we're having the Ryan conversation. I kind of forgot there after a little bit.
Two balls, one strike. Hokuf at second. Ben Har at first after the single by Hokuf. Walk for Har. 2-1. Lacy foul tips it back into the mitt for
that
strike two.
That was a really good breaking ball. Tight break on the curve from Palmer. He hasn't been able to throw it with confidence today. That's the best it's looked.
Two balls and two strikes. Pitch from Palmer. Straight back.
Told you, Palmer came into the game with a 9 ERA at 11 innings pitched, 11 runs, 17 strikeouts. Palmer walked 9 in those 11 innings.
Two, two. Lacy spoils another as that'll be foul. And
tell you, I will always jump at foul balls, I think. I think I'll always jump at foul
really?
Balls.
Really? You think so?
Good buddies with Jeff Haxton, who caught the ball from Texas Tech.
Oh, that's – hey, you know where he went to school?
Oklahoma State. Yeah, Jeff Haxton.
You know where he caught before then? Before Tech?
No, where?
ORU?
Really?
Oral Roberts.
Jeff's a good dude, man. He's got great hands.
Great way to spell Jeff, too.
Yeah. G-E-O-F-F.
2-2 once again coming from Palmer. Lacey reaches for that one, but he stays alive.
Another great at bat after Ben Haar just did that. I mean, you are pummeling Ryan Palmer's pitch count.
That was a reach. 2 out of 10.
What do you mean? You're just pummeling his pitch count. 48 pitches. I wasn't trying for anything. Was there a pun there that I missed?
2-2 with two runners on. Palmer checks the runner Hocuff. Now a pick back. Hocuff in safely as he stays up standing. Close play there, and you could see Kenny Barton saying, hey, slide.
Yeah.
And Hocuff says,
Logan
my bad.
Said, yeah, no, that's probably on me there, Skip. I probably should slide back. Which is true.
That is how you should do it.
You should slide back, especially when you're two steps off and they throw back at you.
You always want to make that tag a reach.
Good back pick, too, from Palmer.
Oh, yes. 2-2. Again. And again a flinch.
For those of you in the grandstands, 3D baseball presented by
the Orange. Seems as though there's been a costume malfunction.
Oh, no.
A costume malfunction with our friend Scoop down here.
Wait, so he's not real?
Oh, I don't think so. There's a fan trying to help him out. I think he had a tag hanging out the back.
2-2 once again, outside in the dirt. Full count, and it'll be the ninth pitch of the AB.
This goes to show what Lacey has done in this at-bat to work the count to full. This lady's pulling up Scoop's shirt and trying to fix the mascot costume in front of God and everybody.
3-2. Lacey into right field, coming on Griffin. He's not going to make the catch as it drops in just fair. Hocuff had to stay put. He'll go to third. The bases will be loaded.
That's the second Texas leaguer in this inning.
Get a little look at Scoopy. Oh, boy.
I mean, that lady is just elbow deep in the mascot.
Just
in the mascot
middle of the
shirt.
Middle of the stands, by the way.
Smith.
No,
I mean,
don't
this
go anywhere
is
else.
Front of everybody.
Don't.
Poor Scoop, dude. Somebody had a costume malfunction, and they've been doing surgery on a mascot for about the last 4 minutes over there. Oh, my.
Specialized
God bless
in mascot
Scoop.
Surgery here in
Kenai. Dude, get it together.
Bases loaded to Miles Smith. Almost hit him. It did.
Oh, wow.
Hit by a pitch. Logan Hocuff trots home. Miles Smith gets first base, and the game is tied at one.
Well, that's not the first time I've seen a free pass cause
no.
a run from
no.
the Peninsula Oilers.
No.
I don't know about you fellas.
You know, it was a pretty famous one of those last night.
Jackson Sorensen.
Right, the first ever win for a organized sports team in sudden death in any sport in history last night.
So, I'm sure it's not, but it's also probably one of the only times you walked it off.
It's definitely not.
It's one of the only times you walked it off on the away field. Strike swinging by Sorensen. He still has the base loaded, and
still
nobody out.
Nobody out here.
Nobody. And you got your leader in batting average at the plate.
Dude, that Scoop deal had me going.
Palmer menacingly looks in. 0-1, looped foul.
A lot of foul
ball brought to you by
which
is great.
And every foul ball is sponsored here at Coral Seymour Park.
Yes,
Stadium.
It is.
Stadium.
Yep. Pizza Pizza.
Pizza Pizza. Now 0-2 here. Bases loaded with Smith at first, Ben Haar at third, and Cade Lacey at second. Palmer. Lined over the head of the second baseman. He jumps to make the grab and falls down. I thought it was going to get over his head, but he just leaps in the air to grab it. Falls down on his backside and either way.
Web gem by Elko. Web gem by Elko. And then on his butt, he throws the ball over to his third baseman, Forshey, to keep anybody from scoring. I mean, you got Ben Haar who could have taken off.
And he thought about it. It was a good piece of hitting there. That would have been the third Texas leaguer we've seen.
Yep.
Zach Thomas, 0-for-1, steps up. Long look in. The pitch outside.
Thomas batting 278 this year. Has 5 RBI. Can add to it. Also 5 walks, only 3 strikeouts.
Trying to break the tie here. It's 1-1. We're in the top of the third. Oilers and Bucks. Palmer's pitch. Flat into right field. Har looking to tag. Right fielder Griffin does not make the grab as it just lands in harmlessly in foul territory for the Oilers. Strike one.
Thomas has a big swing, man. Three hits. Power in those legs. Coach Ken Hochkopf said in a cage match, it's Thomas all day.
Oh, yeah.
Against anybody on this roster.
LSU Eunice.
Jessup, Georgia.
Learn how to wrestle a gator there.
Dude, his country boy loaded.
One ball, one strike, one out, one run in here in the top of the third for the Bucs. Palmer's pitch. Low.
Good eye from Thomas. Told you, for a big boy with a lot of power. Got great patience.
Palmer looks into his catcher, Chavez. Two balls and one strike. Inside, 3-1 now, and nowhere to put Zach Thomas.
Palmer is approaching pitch number 60.
And we're in the top of the third. Good grief.
Yep.
We only have one out in the third, to be honest. 3-1. Strike just on the outside part. Oh, that was a little bit of a gift.
We just spent so much time talking about how good he's done. This is how he treats us.
Right
outside.
At every base, full count pitch from Ryan Palmer to Zach Thomas. Thomas, check swing. Ball four.
They
second.
Don't even check
free
to
run.
See if Thomas went.
No, not at all. Benhar stomps on home plate, and it's 2-1 Bucks.
This is the most anticlimactic.
This is
2-1 lead that I've ever seen.
A walk with the base loaded, or a hit by
Alex
pitch with the base
Pendergast.
Loaded, and now a walk. And now Alex Pendergast, who guess what he did last night, fellas?
yeah, walked with the bases loaded.
First pitch, swing and a miss. It's a fastball up high. And Oilers fans showing a little bit of displeasure.
Yeah, Oilers fans are jumping on the home plate umpire. They thought that last pitch was a strike.
0-1 to Pendergast inside.
Which, based on the strike call the pitch before, I could see the Oilers fans having a point.
It was a high fastball on the first pitch that got Pendergast to swing. An inside fastball there. Lays off and 1-1. Outside, breaking pitch.
Pendergast, 7 for 32 this year. 219 average, has walked six times to five strikeouts.
Well, Burkhalter was the first player we interviewed on the Full Sail pregame show, and in that game, he did really well.
True.
Pendergast trying to match it here. 2-1 outside.
Yeah, 100%. That's not a strike.
No.
And you can see the dramatic movement from the glove of Chavez as he tries to frame it. That's really...
It's clear and obvious.
Right.
It's a ball.
It just shows how far outside the zone the pitch really is.
Three balls and one strike. Palmer at risk of having his third free run. Inside, Pendergast walks for a second time that records an RBI. Kate Lacy steps on home plate. It's 3-1 Bucks.
Oh, no. I have bad news if you're a Peninsula Oiler fan.
Lex.
Number nine.
Lex. Bodinger.
Well, I got even maybe worse news. No one in the bullpen's warming up.
Oh boy!
They just the oil. I can only assume it's due to a
lack in pitching from that yesterday.
Yeah, I think so.
Boedeker, outside. He got his first bomb of the year last night in the game two of that two-game doubleheader, and boy, it was magical.
Well, the fans are not very happy with the umpire right now. They thought that was a strike as well. Again, they got a case. It was close.
Inside on Boedeker, almost hit him. It's 2-0. And Palmer does not know where the strike zone is. Could be right in front of him. He can't find it. And each team 2-0. Boy, Boedeker.
Yeah.
If he gets around on that one, it's a 7-1 ball game, folks. If he gets that. Two balls and one strike. Still a hitter's count. Palmer, a deep breath. The pitch. Skied. Left fielder, Pinkston, now running in. It's going to be caught by the shortstop. Elko tagging up as Smith. Throw is going to be nowhere close as Smith, with the speed, easily scores. Good at the RBI on the sack fly to Lex Boedeker. It's 4-1 Bucs.
Yeah, Boedeker's 283 average will stay intact. He'll get an RBI as well. And something to mention, a good play from Elko. He couldn't really get that ball
16,
in
Trenton,
Kent Smith.
Burkholder.
Not even close because he slipped in the outfield. The grass is soaking wet. It has rained all day today.
And it looks like Palmer checked with the third baseman for Shea to see if Smith left early. The appeal was awarded as safe, so he left on time.
Ooh, and the home plate umpire had some, I don't know what he said, but he had some dramatic motions toward the Oilers dugout. Says, I got it.
I know what's going on here.
Oh, okay.
Two outs now, four runs in the top of the third. Burkhalter at the plate. Breaking pitch that doesn't really break, stays up. 0-1.
Now some movement in the Oilers bullpen.
Elko ran a long way for that ball.
Yeah.
Because Pinkston, he had a bad beat on it. He took a step back before coming in. 1-0 is up. 2-0. Zach Thomas at second, Pendergast at first. Bouncer to third baseman, Forche. He'll step on third, but four runs come in, three of them on either a walk or a hit by pitch, and then the sack fly from Lex Boedeker. Bucs have a lead. We'll go to the bottom of the third here on the Anchorage Bucs Baseball Network.
Imagine how much Mountain Dew is in there.
Hey, guys! We should probably drink these fast!
Fun actually, but mascot problems.
Leading off to the Oilers, number three, Owen McElfatrick.
1, 2, and 3 for the Oilers here in the bottom of the third. Get their second look at Sky.
She just wants to know her name.
That's all she wants to know. McElfatrick swinging on the first pitch. Sorensen stops it. Throw on to Zach Thomas in time. A nice little play there from Sorensen for first pitch, first out.
Boy, that's solid. That was really good contact. And Sorensen just a hoover at third.
Now batting number two, Kirby Pinkston.
Why they call it the hot corn.
Kirby Pinkston steps up. He's 0 for 1. Ball just a bit high.
I don't know if that's what it was.
Strike.
Yeah.
But it was called a ball.
Strike just a bit high. We did. We were so nice. We were overly nice.
1-0. That's a strike.
So we baked the guy a cake up in this broadcast. We asked for this. Gone both ways.
And that's the one thing that we appreciate about
today. Oh, 100%. If it's the same for both teams, then we're good.
And that was the biggest thing last night when Hocuff got ejected. It wasn't that it was a bad strike zone. You can have a bad strike zone, but just call it both ways for that way.
Right.
Obviously, it's not ideal to have a bad strike zone. 2-1. On the ground.
Oh!
Behind the back grab by Wells. The throw to Thomas in time. Sky couldn't see the ball, and he snags it.
I love the reaction of the dugout and the infield. Just dumbfounded that Sky Wells threw his glove behind his back, hoping for the best, and there's the baseball.
Wow. Well then.
Ben Griffin. I mean, wow.
That's impressive. 1-0. That was a, hey, look what I found strike.
That's the best defensive play we may have seen the Bucs make this year. We've seen a couple web gyms in the outfield, but that was.
Did it with his eyes.
Sorcery.
The other way.
Sorcery.
1-1. Outside, it's 2-1.
Keep your eyes peeled. We might see a pitching change in the top of the fourth. Ryan Palmer, after 3 innings and 4 earned runs, 4 walks, his day might be done.
2-1. Pop foul by the batter Griffin. It's 2-2.
Foul ball brought to you by Michael and Diane Tice.
Griffin batting 319 this year. 0-1 today. Oilers have just one hit.
That's all they got.
It's been an error and a walk that helped them push their one run across.
2-2. Bounce foul.
Bucks have 4 runs on 3 hits, 1 error. The Oilers a run on a hit, no errors. Wells, who I told you is top 10 in the league in strikeouts, has gone 2 2/3 without a single strikeout.
2 balls, 2 strikes, just outside of a run full.
He has only walked 1, which is a big improvement from that Matsu game where he went 1 1/3 and walked 5.
He'd only walked 2 in the previous 2 appearances. Full count pitch. Strike 3. Ben Griffin, take a seat via the sorcerer, Sky Wells. We'll go to the top of the fourth. Bucs 4, Oilers 1 on the Anchorage Bucs Baseball Network.
Stay away from my wife.
Hi, I'm Ben Stiller. My job as an actor is making you believe what you're seeing is real.
Louise, will you?
The pain is real.
That the cold is real. Don't say that about yourself. I know. I know.
But friendship is real.
The real is real.
But it's not real, it's just acting. Wow, that's like really good. Or was I just acting? Only way to know is to try it for yourself.
This is really, really ridiculously good tasting.
Welcome back to Coral Seymour Stadium. Jace Andrews and Drake Toll here with you. Got a new pitcher on the mound. It's William Grimm. Funny enough, he was a position player yesterday. Take the bump now as he throws from the left side. And Drake, we're working on a stat right now. Do you got to finish on the walk stat?
Yeah, so the Bucs had walked. Well, I was thinking the Bucs have looked a lot better with control the last couple of days. And, well, kind of. They had 6 walks in game 1 of this series against the Oilers. 6 walks in game 2 yesterday, or game 3, I guess I should say. And then in game 2, they only had 1. So they're still sitting at 13 walks in 3 games. Not elite, but better than the season average. So that has
Taking
improved,
Bucks,
but
17,
still work
Logan
to go.
Hoka.
There was 9 batters that came to the plate in the top of the third, so we'll start with Logan Hoke up here in the top of the fourth. He swings the first pitch, and it's a strike because he misses the ball a little bit out in front.
Grimm, 5'11", 185 from Loyola Marymount. Pitched against the Bucs.
The one is foul, tipped off the glove of the catcher.
Yesterday. Just kidding. That was
about to say that's the batter, right?
That's just 4 at bats. Here's the pitching game. Loggies appeared 1 time. Got a win, actually.
Wouldn't be the Hokuf. So we're gonna miss.
Would not be the first time that we've seen a pitcher go back to back days.
Yeah, no, it wouldn't.
It's happened a couple times here in the ABL.
It is a little rare, but we have seen it.
Not batting. Number 3, Ben Har.
One
So he's 1-0. Two innings, one strikeout, one walk.
What was the final score of the game he pitched in?
The final score, 15-1.
And he got the win?
He got the win in a 15-1 game.
Huh.
Wow. Yeah, oh, dude, don't ask me. That I also have questions. I also have questions.
A little bit of way there.
That said, should he have gotten the win?
We don't know.
Nobody knows. In the ABL, point streak is just a figment of our imaginations. Stats don't exist. No one's counting. The points don't matter.
Who's on it anyway? 2-0 to Benhar. He walked last time up. So has that 259 average intact. Side with that one. It's 3-0.
Grimm played for the Walla Walla Sweets last summer.
Walla Walla.
Walla Walla. Washington. The lefty at Walla Walla had a 250 batting average and a 415 ERA.
Strike taken at the plate by Har.
Had 8 appearances in the West Coast League at Walla Walla.
3-1. Strike.
West Coast League, the new home of Nolan Wilson.
Yes. It's a good league.
Yeah. He'll have get a lot of good reps down there, have a lot of fun, too.
Full count now. Strike 3 to Harris. He watches it, and he knew it.
Yeah.
3-1. William Grimm works backwards to get the strikeout.
Yeah. For Grimm, 8 2/3 last summer, allowed 10 hits, 4 earned runs, couple of home runs as well. 2 walks, 12 strikeouts at 8 2/3. Good control.
Back to the top of the order, Cade Lacy, who is 1-for-2 today. Swinging for the fences there, comes up empty. Lacy had the Texas leaguer down that first base line last inning. This time it's looped into left field, dropping for a base hit. It'll get down. He's 2-for-3.
Same thing. That one a little bit.
I've seen a lot of those.
It was better hit.
That was a little
than
better.
His first base hit.
The first one was much more high.
Yep.
Than
this
straight.
Is just a little. It looked
how
just
about number 23, Miles Smith.
Put your bat out. Pump it over the shortstop Elko's head.
We've seen a lot of those, and we've seen one that was robbed by the shortstop Elko.
Uh-huh, yep.
Yeah, just bloopers, Texas leaguers, whatever you want to call them. That's been the way of the Bucs bat tonight. Miles Smith watches outside. Bucs, as I mentioned, can win the series today.
They would move to 6-1 against the Oilers this year if they win.
1-0 is a looping breaking ball that does not get the strike call.
No, yeah, that's a little inside. By the time it hits the catcher's glove, it's right at the knees and the heart of the plate. But when it crosses the plate, it's not a strike. That is the right call.
Good umpire. Right there.
Yeah.
Better to watch where it crosses than where it's caught. Fastball.
Okay.
Maybe that one.
Okay.
Maybe
all
that
right.
One.
We'll give it. Yeah, yeah. That
was a strike.
That's what they call a strike in the game of baseball.
Oh, well.
49 states, Guam, just not Alaska.
3-0. That's outside. 4-pitch walk to Miles Smith.
Oiler fan says, good job, Blue.
He's wearing black.
I'm telling you, I look, these two teams have gone back and forth a bit with the drawing. That's
30,
why both
Jackson
dugouts were told
Sorensen
to be quiet for this game. But the fans, they get on a little bit. And again, I appreciate it. I appreciate the fans are that invested.
It's always fun when you have a good fan group for a summer baseball.
I really
think
so.
It makes it a lot better. First pitch to Sorensen. Big hack and a miss. And I think the biggest thing is fans that come to summer leagues and actually want their team to win and want to watch them succeed. Because there's a lot of summer leagues out there. You go there and just for a good time. You don't really care if the team wins or loses. But maybe, there are some very passionate fans.
And it's so much a part of baseball.
0-1. Sorensen, nubbed on the ground. Shortstop Elko. He's going to go to first. Sorensen is out. Elko to Rada. And the two-out threat is wiped away by William Grimm. We'll go to the bottom of the fourth. Bucs 4.
Oilers 1 on the Anchorage Bucs Baseball Network.
Feels like just yesterday she was in a car seat. Now she's going to be in the driver's seat. I guess there's a first time for everything. Today is all about the basics. Gotta have unbeatable focus. Kind of like the unbeatable mileage I get from Chevron with Techron. He knows it helps keep my engine clean. And she knows how to pay with the Chevron app. Everyone's learning today. Okay, next stop, the parking lot. The empty parking lot.
Unbeatable mileage for you and your car.
This is Lulu and Lobo.
Ah, it's back!
The woo-woo monster! No, no! 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 Yeah, I can't take this! We need a new place!
With as low as 3% down on a fixed-rate mortgage, your new home is within reach.
All clear. It went home.
Deep breath, deep breath, deep breath.
Talk to a home mortgage consultant or apply online. This is your way home. This is Wells Fargo.
Welcome back here to Kenai, Alaska. Jace Andrews alongside Drake Toll, along with our social media director, Harper Mayfield, and Annika Morris, part of the social media team here for the Bucs.
Nine innings today.
Yeah, nine full.
Leading off number 26, Nick Costello.
Costello steps up. He's rather one for one, the fourth slot today. He's got a over 470 average.
Yeah. Pretty good. Pretty good.
Pretty good. Decent there. First pitch from Wells. And the Sorcerer's first pitch is low.
Costello at 500 now. He is 9, 10. 10 for 20.
Looks to bunt. Pulls back. Takes a strike. We talked about nicknames earlier today, and I think we have some nicknames for certain people that nobody knows about. I mean, Cameron Crane is Mr. Inevitable.
Inevitable, yes.
And then...
Well, I wouldn't even say Mr. He's just inevitable. Yeah. The Mr. I think Mr.
One
is...
One. Looped. Foul territory. Sorensen racing that way. It's going to land in the beer garden.
In my opinion, I think throwing Mr. on the front of a nickname just kind of dilutes the nickname.
That's fair.
It's like calling Missouri the Show Me State. You put state at the end of it, it dilutes it. It's terrible. The Last Frontier, much better.
Way
what was
better.
Your point here with nicknames?
I think Sky Wells earned one today. Sorcerer?
Oh yeah, I kind of like that.
Fits with his S. Inside, almost at the face of Costello. Sky the Sorcerer.
You mentioned the beer garden. It butts up. It is right on top of the Anchorage Bucs bullpen.
Yeah.
So those fans can say whatever they want.
2-2. Strike three! Sky Wells picks up another K. And,
wow.
Nick Costello
got not just one or two words in. He got all of the words in with the home plate umpire pointing at him, waving his finger at him, waving the bat at him.
I'm very surprised he was not.
No warning or anything.
Nothing.
This poor home plate umpire. It's a lonely, lonely job up there.
Your only friends are
your
other two
guys. He was waving his finger at him. you got me.
I don't think he was saying that.
Yeah.
May have been some not safe for radio words.
Oh, yeah. Jeez.
That was a very good finger wag.
It was nice.
Was
a lot of swagger in that finger wag from Costello.
1-0 from the left.
Of course, he didn't get thrown out.
Yeah. Strike. Ken Hoka, you're ruining a good game. Goodbye.
Don't play umpire.
Point my finger. Nah, you're fine.
Don't play umpire looked at the Oilers dugout as he yelled strike. Quite loudly as well. He wanted everybody to know.
1-1. Inside, 2-1. Sky Wells, decently efficient today. Was he? He's riding up to about 55 pitches area?
Close.
55?
Almost. 50. This should be 55 here, yeah.
Bottom of the fourth. That's pretty good. 2-1. Roped into right field for a base hit. Boedeker gets it in quickly. Limits Forche to a single. Ball does get away from Pendergast, but it goes right towards the shortstop Hoka, who's at second.
Forche's first hit this evening brings up Chavez. Chavez, 207 average, 7 points above the Mendoza line. has walked 8 times compared to his 5 strikeouts.
Burkhalter going to come out and talk to his pitcher here now with the runner at first.
Now, so you mentioned Ken Hocup. Who is listening tonight? He is not allowed to be in the ballpark today after yesterday's ejection, but again, it is an example of a coach. I would say it to his face. This is not me. I know Ken Hocup's listening tonight, but it's something I'd say to him, and the players would echo it too. When your summer ball coach gets thrown out of a game, yeah, that just shows how much you are going to bat for a bunch of kids you met 2 weeks ago. There aren't a lot of summer ball coaches. I believe it. There aren't a lot of summer ball coaches who would fight for their players like that.
Ball outside. And I think the biggest thing is, as soon as Hocup was ejected, the team rallied together immediately.
The Bucs are 2-0. The Bucs are 2-0 in games Ken Hocup gets ejected. One of them they were down 4-0, and the other they were tied 5-5.
1-1, bounce to the first baseman. Thomas on to second. He needs a tag. Did he get it implied? He did. Double play with the 3-6. Nice play by Thomas and a good tag applied by Logan Hocup. We go to the bottom, or rather top of the fifth inning here at Coral Seymour Stadium on the Anchorage Bucs Baseball Network.
They call him the harder farmer, a real bad man with a soft side for hard lemonade. He's got a nose for lemons and for trouble. This time he's back with half tea, half lemonade, and 100% oh wow.
Oh wow!
Get your hands on some today before the harder farmer gets his hands on you.
When Subway opened, they changed the fast food game. But sometimes you gotta refresh to be fresh. Welcome to the Eat Fresh Refresh, where there's so much new, some say it can't fit in one ad. I say, we're talking a new All-American Club, deli-style oven-roasted turkey, and...
Oh, that's the new steak and cheese.
Oh, yeah, I knew that. That's the one with the new seasoning.
And that was the new MVP Parmesan vinaigrette.
Right, which makes the next level foot... Hold up, Subway logo? Wait, I'm out of...
are up 4-1. William Grimm back on the mound. 4-5-6, middle of the order for the Bucs. Top of the fifth.
It's about to be in. Thomas, Pendergast, Boedeker. Will
Zach
Grimm.
Thomas.
First pitch to Thomas. Low. Chavez tried to pull it up.
I really wanted a Gatorade today, and turns out Coral Gables ball field does not have Gatorade. You know what they do have?
Fouls. What do they have?
Powerade. And it's terrible.
You know what I realized too?
Terrible. You know what? I've never met a person who said, "Hey, do you have any Powerade?" What? Be
they
a
also,
mad man.
They have red because Oilers are red.
It's like you just take. It's like you take water.
1-1. Thomas in the air as it's popped to the second baseman Groupie, who makes the grab.
You take water and you add a little bit of sugar and some red food coloring. It's just bad. It's just bad.
How much have you drinking of it?
A lot, because I've out of necessity. We hiked a 3,000-mile mountain up and back today.
Pendergast.
We did.
For 5 hours.
And got rained on.
Yeah, it rained hard.
I had some rain here, though. That was pretty good.
Uh-huh. Pendergast, 0-for-1 with an RBI today. You know how he got his RBI?
Walk with the base loaded.
What's his on-base streak at? Probably close to double-digit games.
I think it's at 7.
Really? I don't know. It could
Sorensen's at 11.
Ooh.
Pendergast, deep right field, going back as Griffin. It's going to bounce. It's foul. Just inches to the right of the line, according to the first base umpire. I think it may have been fair.
Yeah, I think that's what first base coach Mike Sarhat is saying as well, without saying too much. Sarhat, the team dad. Him and Cameron Crane both do a great job in that role.
They do. They do.
Sarhat, a player, can't do too much jawing or questioning over there. Yeah, that was foul. It was by a blade of grass.
1-1 for Pendergast.
The outfield also slopes off. That one was. Foul
ball brought to you by Joseph Kashi.
It was close. Jackson Sorensen has an 11-game on-base streak, though.
11 for Sorensen.
Yes. For Pendergast, I think it's 7.
Okay.
1-2.
See, Kenny Barton just dropped it. We wouldn't have this information if you weren't doing point streak. The Oilers, the Peninsula Oilers, are supposed to have an official scorekeeper, someone to do point streak, and just to peel the curtain back, your play-by-play guy tonight is the official scorekeeper of the Peninsula Oilers this week because they couldn't find anybody to do the game. It's mandated by the league.
Fun times. 1-2. Strike 3. Pendergast doesn't like the call, but I think it was a strike.
Pendergast did not wave his finger at him, though.
No.
Give him that. Yeah, wouldn't you know? Credit to you, partner, for doing the official scorekeeping here with nobody said thank you. Nobody's given you a burger or a hot dog or.
That was denied, actually.
You were denied food yesterday, and you're doing somebody else's job, an Oiler's job. And, they've been so hospitable here. Great people here in Kenai, but wow, man.
Whitaker slaps it foul.
Foul ball brought to you by the Jonas Brothers.
If you weren't doing the point streak, there wouldn't be stats for these games for either team. You're benefiting both of these squads and doing somebody else's job at their home ballpark.
Well, that was the biggest thing is these stats are important, especially for every player. I mean, this is their livelihood.
It is their livelihood.
0-1 lifted into center field. Costello to his right makes the catch. Bucs go quietly here in the top of the fifth. Bottom half coming up on the Anchorage Bucs Baseball Network.
We are a family business serving Alaskans for over 60 years. Our founder is my dad, Herb Ekman, a German immigrant who started the business in 1963 with his good friend, Otto. To this day, the business is dedicating to making products that are distinctive and of the highest quality.
When Arby's added bacon to the Wagyu Steakhouse burger, it was like, not bad. Then Arby's grabbed that peppercorn ranch and has never felt more alive. Arby's, we have the meat.
In 1986, we started Alaskan Brewing Company. And so we've always tried to reflect the quality that the state has in the beers that we make.
Alaska's beautiful, it's true, it's real.
For 30 years, we've been trying to capture the nature of Alaska and put it in a bottle. Today, 30 years later, we're still making beer in the last frontier.
The Alaska Baseball League here on the Anchorage Bucs Baseball Network. Sky Wells on the mound for the Bucs. It's 4-1 as we head to the bottom of the fifth, Jace Andrews. Greg Dole here with you this evening, or this midnight, wherever you may be watching. It's getting late on the lower 40.
Sitting out for the Oilers.
7-8-9.
Michael Rutta.
Oilers here in the bottom of the fifth. Sky Wells. Pretty solid game thus far. One run, two hits. Four full innings. First pitch of the fifth is outside. Rutta. Walked his first time up overall.
185 average, 15 points below the Mendoza line.
1-0. Swing and a miss.
Ball is in the left-handed batter's box. Rutta stuck the bat out.
I'd go there again. 1-1. Does exactly that, but a little bit too far this time. 2-1. Swing and a miss. Strike two. All right, yesterday
Wells has not put a ball in the strike zone of this at bat.
He has not. It's all been in the right-handed hitting or left-handed hitting batter's box, and they're still 2-2 count. 2-2. Great breaking
when
pitch.
Abner Doubleday invented this game, he distinguished a strike zone, and that is what he distinguished it for those to be called strikes. Sky Wells takes some extra time off the mound.
He needs a second to recuperate after that. 3-2, come back with your best pitch. Fouled right into the Oilers dugout.
Doubleday is rolling over in his grave.
He's curling up. Full count. Another foul. I'll tell you, if he watched what happened last night, he may rise up.
Yeah. Abner Doubleday is probably not happy.
That is not what he intended for
the
baseball.
The base is loaded walk in sudden death in the ninth inning.
3-2. Again, a foul tip. Staying alive.
Again, even while it was a seven-inning game to start. That went nine, and we played sudden death in the top of the ninth. Oh, was it even the top of the ninth? The innings didn't count.
It didn't matter.
At that point, right.
There was sudden death. There wasn't
no such thing as an inning at that point. Wells.
3-2 again. Good AB by Rada. He works the leadoff walk.
Wells now at 65 pitches, 39 strikes, 26 balls.
Elko, 0-for-1.
Now batting number 12, Michael Elko.
146 average.
I feel like this is the same walk-up song.
I think so.
Beside me.
Sky Wells check on the runner at first. And again at the plate, more foul balls. We've seen a ton of those today.
Elko batting 146.
I don't know. Is in the APL, is it a souvenir, or do you have to give the ball back?
It's a souvenir.
I think so.
Oh, geez. Is the Coastal Plains a souvenir? It should be a souvenir in every league.
That's what I thought, but Coastal Plains, at a certain point, they stopped making souvenirs.
Really? They make you bring the ball back.
There was like 50 foul balls, I will say, before they kind of got to that. But
well, what are they going to do with it?
That was my
Somebody hit it out of the ballpark. You're going to bring it back, throw it in the field of play?
Well, so what happened is they used them for batting practice balls.
Okay. I can get with that, I guess.
0-2. Little fly to left field. Ben R. Roams to his right, makes the catch.
Elko got all the way up under it. Good on Wells. He knows he's hitting about the 70 pitch mark. 0-2. Let's go into the zone.
Let's attack.
Now batting number one, Brett Groupie.
Groupie batting 186 this year. Get this. Here's some of the batting averages in the starting five today. 188, 214, 200, 185, 143, 186, Brett Groupie. That is...
Not the greatest.
Oh, yeah. This Oilers team has struggled to hit.
Strike. Good pitch there by Sky Wells.
They're facing a Bucs squad that's been at the forefront of hitting in the ABL this season.
Yeah, the fourth best average in the league for the Oilers, the second best for the Bucs.
Six guys batting 270 or better in the Bucs lineup today.
Runner still at first, the 0-1. Fouled.
Oh, Sky Wells, who led the league in strikeouts for a while. Remember, he had 9 in 4 innings in his first appearance, Game 2 this year. Looked like Cy Young against the Matsu Miners. He's only struck out 2 today.
Could get a chance for a third one here. 0-2 count. The 9 slot, Brett Groupie. Runner at first base. The pitch. Check swing. No appeal. I don't think he went across anyway.
Where did that miss?
That was the other part I was going to say. It didn't.
Wow.
That was a top corner strike, my friend. Other than that, really, 1-2. That's a ball.
Yeah. Bucs dugout really wanted it.
It's a great pitch, but it is just off.
Come
2-2 from the Long Beach State University, Sky Wells. Long check at the runner at first. That one misses. Funny enough, Sky's been mainly a starter here for your Bucs, but he led Long Beach State in saves with 6th. That was 7th in the conference. He's the closer. Full count pitch. Popped into foul territory. Moving to his right is Thomas. It's going to go into the stands.
Foul ball brought to you by Bill Parker.
We'll have another full count pitch here. Guy at a 4.97 ERA at Long Beach State. 1.22 whip. Solid right there. 3-2. Over to left. Base hit. Ben Haar cuts it off. A nice play by Haar to make sure it does not get past him. It does get past both Hokup and Sorensen. Burkhalter in the right spot, though, as it'll keep the runners at first and second. Another single puts runners at first and second. Now with still one out.
Righty up and throwing in the pen for the Bucs, and that might be the day for Wells. He doesn't want it to be the day, though. You could see as soon as
I think he wants
Bishop Grigg started coming out of the dugout, Wells immediately looked at the pen. He was shocked that somebody was up.
And Griggs is the pitching coach tonight, still, because it's going to be Kenny Barton who's the head coach. So could be just a pitching meeting. That's what Kenny told me today.
Kenny's the head coach. Good for you there, Kenny. So if the Bucs win tonight, Kenny is 1-1.
He is?
Yeah, they're going to leave Wells in. I can tell you, based off of mannerisms alone, that Wells wanted to stay in the game if the decision was his.
She wants a ground ball here. Miguel Patrick. Already had one on the ground today.
But this is going to do it. Oh, he will. He's gone 4 1/3, closing in on 80 pitches. Well, 75. This will be his 75th.
I think they're going to let him try and get out of this inning.
Yep.
Any run comes across, though, it's game over here.
Uh-huh.
1-0. Off the glove of Wells. Throw back from Burkhalter, but everybody stays put. Miguel Patrick. Batting below the Mendoza line now after an over two start today.
6-4-32 on his season. 1 home run, 3 RBI.
Check on the run of the 1-0. Low.
Miguel Patrick was the shortstop yesterday.
DH today at the leadoff. Sky Wells, the 2-0 count, want to try and get back in the strike zone here.
You have to.
Oh! Ball that was hit off the top of the...
I have never seen that.
There was a bar, and it hit straight down into the stands.
Lucky it didn't hit a fan.
Yeah.
It went right above the net, hit off the top bar.
That's why there's no netting there, which kind of doesn't make any sense.
Right. No, it makes zero sense.
I would either remove the bars or put netting there.
Off the bar and almost hit a young fan in the front row.
2-1 lace in the right field for a base hit. Boedeker going to throw it over to third. Cut off by Hokuff. 4-2. Coming home to score for the Oilers. There's Rada. RBI single for Miguel Patrick. And I think that might be the end of the day here. Well, we're waiting.
Bishop Griggs has not moved from the dugout.
To Kirby Pinkston.
They may go lefty-lefty here.
Yeah. Work the matchup with Pinkston. First pitch, I don't know where that missed. Runners on the corners right now.
I don't know if it did miss.
I don't think it did either.
Pinkston.
0 for 2 today.
Yep.
1-0. Back to Wells. Throws to Hokuff at second. On to first.
in time.
Huge. What a huge play from Sky Wells. Hoke up with a great throw back to first as well. That saves a run from scoring. Wells could have thrown it home and gotten a pickle between third and home plate, but instead makes the right call, gets the double play. Just a heads-up play from Sky Wells.
Knowing what you're going to do with the ball as soon as you get it is such a key instinct, and Wells knew exactly after he got that ball. Go to second, get the double play, and that's exactly what happened. One run does come across. We'll go to the top of the sixth. Bucs 4, Oilers 2 on the Anchorage Bucs Baseball Network.
I'm currently the discipline engineering team leader at BP Wynn. I'm actually a chemical engineer by training. I started my career in the upstream oil and gas division. Spent about 8 years supporting operations, both in onshore and offshore processing platform. I knew I was ready for a change. As luck had it, I ended up in Wynn on a short-term assignment, which then I knew it had to turn into a long-term assignment. I think if I were to advise people who are in upstream now and would like to transition into renewables, I would say learn as much as you can about the actual problems that wind farms face, the challenges they have to overcome, and how your skill set can help solve those problems. The general operating principles and operating rigor is the same, whether you're in upstream oil and gas or supporting operations on a wind farm.
William Grimm back on the mound here for the Oilers. He'll face 7-8-9, Burkhalter, Hokeup, and Haar. First pitch to Tritton is a strike taken. Burkhalter thought about a swing, but ultimately holds up, but called by the home plate umpire either way. 1-1. Fastball outside park, doesn't get the call. 1-1.
Yeah. Again, both teams.
It's been consistent.
Yep. Yep.
Which is nice.
Yep. That's what we ask for.
Grimm the lefty, 1-1. Burkhalter watches a breaking pitch that drops over the plate, first strike.
If the zone is inconsistent, but for both teams, we'll play ball.
That's 1-2. Burkhalter just kind of nubs it foul out of here.
Foul ball.
You know, we've had three games this year, I think, where we have truly made remarks about the strike zone. Three, maybe four over the course of the 15. Not a bad ratio for summer ball.
1-2. Skied. Right side. First baseman Rada leans to his right and makes the catch.
And three of those four have had a commonality. We'll just put it that way.
Now batting number 17, Logan Hokeup.
Hokeup, 1-2.
Maybe two of the four.
Either way, there was four bad performances according to us. Swing and a miss from Hokeup. He walked
Hokeup,
his first time.
1-2.
Yeah,
got a base hit.
Base hit his first time and came around to score.
Average sits at 132.
Struck out last AB. Rolled to second base. Groupie scoops it up, throws to first. Two gone.
Now Ben Haar.
Haar is 0-1, but
now batting number 3. Ben,
what he has today?
Haar.
He has walked.
The Bucs, it was a good AB too.
Bucs have struck out four times as a team.
Two of those come from the 8-9 slot. This pitch too hard as a strike taken.
Bucs fielding percentage up to .941. Errors at 26, 11 more than the Glacier Pilots, who are in fourth place in the league. Not great.
No. 0-1. Haar, absolute missile, but straight up. It's a home run in a silo, but here it's an out as the second baseman Groupie makes the grab. And the Bucs go 1-2-3 in the top of the sixth. Oilers coming up here on the Anchorage Bucs Baseball Network.
When I first moved to Alaska, my whole family was saying, oh boy, this is a strange phase in his life.
I saw pictures of the place, gorgeous scenery, and then I took a summer job here and fell totally in love with the mountains, the ocean, everything. But I think what kept me here was the people.
The idea of starting a brewery seemed to match and mesh what we enjoyed about our life up here. Each other, beer, working hard, and creating something.
When we started out really small, we only sold our beer in Alaska. Now that we sell our beer outside, when I travel and I see our beer, it's neat to think that it came all the way from Alaska and I had a hand in making it.
The nature of starting a business in Alaska really was just an extension of what Alaska's all about. There needs to be somewhat of a free spirit, a frontier.
We just wanted to make a living up here and brew beer and have fun. We're doing the best we can to put Alaska in a bottle.
Jace Andrews, Drake Toll, watching baseball in Alaska. The book is done on Sky Wells. Five innings pitched, four hits, two runs, one of them earned, two walks, two strikeouts, as he faced 20 batters. He goes five complete innings. He's relieved by Curtis Hebert. Drake?
Curtis Hebert, Big Kurt, 3.60 ERA, has pitched in two games. The Bucs has been one of the league leaders all year long in batting average at the plate, and he does it all. Your everyday Shohei Ohtani in the ABL. Five innings, four strikeouts, three walks, two hits allowed in those five innings. Hebert making his third appearance today. Both times he's pitched have been against the Chugiak Chinooks. Has not gotten a decision yet. Could not get a win here. Not as of now.
I was about to say, with the score being as is it is, he doesn't want to win.
Right. So wants to keep that whole decisionless streak alive.
Leading off the order is number 15, Ben Griffin.
I tell you, the camaraderie on this team is very much showing, because the throw down there, it was Burke Coulter to Pendergast, former teammates at Kirkwood Community College, and it was a high catch for Pendergast. He just catches the ball. He stares in at Burkhalter. He just stares at him. Just looks at him. That's popped in the air. Way up there, left side of the infield. Hocuff makes the catch as he calls off Jackson Sorensen. And for Curtis Hebert, one pitch, one out.
All right. It was interesting. I was
a couple of those games.
Looking today, actually, at the standing, league standings. And wow, the Glacier Pilots 7-5, the Bucs 8-7, the Miners 6-6, the Oilers 5-8, the Chinooks 5-6. Everybody is just dancing right around 500.
Hebert's first pitch to Costello is a called strike inside part of the plate.
It is a league of anarchy right now. This is the we're almost to the halfway point.
Yeah, it's just teams beating each other.
What an astute observation. That is what this is.
Fly ball. Ben Hard does not make the catch. A sliding attempt there. Well, it's a good. I think it's the weird thing is about that is that the Chinooks have beaten the Miners a couple times.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
But
right.
The Bucks.
The Chinooks will go beat the Pilots, the Miners by seven.
And then
the Bucks play the Pilots,
Bucks.
The Miners, and they're like, oh, well, I forgot how to do baseball.
But then the Bucks play the Chinooks, and it's a mercy rule.
And then the Oilers go play the Glacier Pilots. They win 10-4. It's like, oh, well, what's happening? It's the
Everybody.
Bucks have had the Chinooks number
people
and the Oilers number.
People have different numbers in this
the
league.
The Miners have, and the Pilots have had the Bucks number. And everybody is kind of in that way as their own kryptonite.
0-2 from Curtis Hebert. Strike three. Swing and a miss. Nick Costello. See you later.
I like that Curtis Hebert guy, man.
Left
good breaking ball. Starts right above the knee. By the time he gets to the glove of Burkhalter, it's just above
Theo
the toe.
Theo
Forshe comes up. He's one for two. Forshe comes in here now with a 333 average as he started today, 285.
Sorry, I didn't mean to speak over you. The Bucs have struck out 132 players this season coming into today's games. That number's only going to go up. That's the most in the league by 29 strikeouts.
Goodness.
It's the dualities of this team are really wild. 1-1.
The Bucs have also allowed the most hits and the most runs. 14 unearned runs this year. That's not as bad as the minors, though. Where do you get a load of this?
Orche watches is 3-0.
The Miners have allowed 60 runs this year, only 42 of them earned. 18 unearned runs in 100 innings.
Oh, my gosh.
That's what we call in the industry not good.
See, that's funny. The 3-0 pitch to Orche, strike taken outside part. The funny thing is the Bucs have the most errors by anybody on the team, anybody in the league, but the unearned runs, I mean, they don't really...
They're not the worst.
They're not the worst. They're not bad.
They're not the worst.
For how many errors you have, it's not bad. 3-1, also a strike. Curtis Abear working from behind, now a full count.
The Miners have the best ERA in the league, and they are 6-6.
3-2. Just fouled as he tops it.
What you got, partner?
Nothing. Full count pitch again here from Hebert. Strike three, Curtis Hebert. 1-2-3. We go to the seventh. Bucs 4, Oilers 2. Curtis Hebert gets the side in order on the Anchorage Bucs Baseball Network.
Boar's Head has harnessed the power of fire to unlock an intense new flavor. An expertly charred, flame-grilled masterpiece to take your senses to new heights. Because when Boar's Head lights a fire, we ignite an experience worth savoring. New Boar's Head Firesmith Flame-Grilled Chicken Breast. Flavor forged in flame. Available only at the deli and only from Boar's Head. Compromise elsewhere.
If there's one thing I've learned at Speedy Glass, it's that every chip becomes a crack. Today, I'm going to show you why. When we look at a chip up close, we see tons of tiny cracks that are just waiting to spread. Don't wait for your chip to crack. Repair it at Speedy Glass before having to replace the entire windshield. You'll save time. You'll be back on the road within an hour. Book an appointment at speedyglass.ca.
Speedy Glass Repair. Speedy Glass Replace.
Bucks had a new pitcher at the top of the and the bottom of the sixth. Now it's the Oilers who have a new pitcher at the top of the seventh. The day is done for William Grimm. Three innings pitched, one hit, no runs, one walk, three strikeouts, 11 batters faced. He gives way to Mose Hayes.
Mose, baby, Mose Hayes. 21 appearances at Yuba Community College in the spring. 3-1 record, one save, 45 and two-thirds, 50 strikeouts, 4.73 ERA. Mose Hayes also walked 21 in that span as well. In the ABL, he has pitched three innings, one strikeout, two walks, three hits, three ERA, has given up one earned run. Pitched against the Bucs, two innings on June 11th in a 5-3 loss for the Oilers. He had one earned run in those two innings, a couple of hits, a couple of walks as well. He got a haircut.
He did.
Since then.
Just a tad.
Good
just
for him.
Just a little trim.
A little off the sides there, Mose.
1-2-3 for
still
him.
Still rocking a lot of hair, dude. Guys, look at this.
He's got a pop it off the back.
Box number
flow.
20, Cade Lacy.
Nice little flow there from Mose.
Oh, yeah. It's curly, too.
Good shot. Lacy stepping up. He'll be followed by Miles Smith and Jackson Sorens in this inning, all with above 300 batting averages.
Mose Hayes, everybody.
Mose Hayes.
That's a good camera.
Lacy watches the pitch, hits the ball. All right, well, it's that time, top of the seventh.
Hey,
you know what
deal.
The game we play is. What national day is today, Drake? And I've got a three hints laid out that I think are good
you
after my bad one yesterday. I've got three hints that I can give you.
Oh, that was a great pitch from Hayes. Should have been a strike. Close. They called it a ball.
2-0.
National, we've already eaten at the only two restaurants open after 10 in Kenai Day. So we're going to have to eat at one of them again tonight. Brothers.
I can't believe it. You're wrong.
National Folk Music Day.
You did not just do that.
Really?
No.
That was good. That was really impressive.
3-1.
Hitters count. You either get ball 4 or something you like. All right, what's your hand?
3 Bears.
National National Bottled Water Day.
No. Again, I have 3 hints laid out. This is just the first one, so don't.
Okay. National Alaskan Native Gas Station Day.
Least foul by Kate Lacey. 3-2. Nope.
All right, what's hint number 2?
Family of Bears.
Oh, National Rhyme Day.
Any guesses from our from Harper?
National Fable Day. National Goldilocks and the Three Bears Day.
Whoa. The Goldilocks and the Three Bears is actually the next hint.
Yeah. Oh, great.
Ball 4 for Cade Lacey. No.
Now batting number 23, Miles Smith.
I've got one more hint for you.
All right, what's your other hint?
One's too hot, one's too cold, one's just right.
National Porridge Day?
It is National Porridge Day. Get yourself some porridge. Miles Smith, why don't you get yourself some porridge?
National Porridge Day. That's the worst.
Kate Lacey at first. I'm proud of my hints, though. I thought that was a good.
Yeah,
that's
no,
some better
hints good
today.
Hints. Those were good hints.
That's why.
I would have said one hint. The first hint would have been oatmeal.
That's good.
What? Porridge and oatmeal, the same thing.
What? Can we look this up? What is porridge and oatmeal's like differences?
We can look it up. We can look
Harper,
it up.
Harper, can you do that? Thank you.
Please.
Please. Sorry. Thank you.
Manners.
Miles Smith with a 1-0 count. Kate Lacey at first with a walk.
Yes.
Strike taken.
Our porridge eaters will know. They are screaming at the TV right now. Porridge is made of a variety of whole grains, cereal, or legumes.
Follow up question.
Oatmeal is made with, any guesses in the booth?
Oats.
That would be oats.
Ball taken by Miles Smith. Follow up. What exactly is a legume?
Right. If you eat oatmeal every day with legumes in it,
it's porridge.
You need to rethink what you're calling oatmeal, because that's porridge, my friend.
Lacey at first, Miles Smith with a 1-2 count.
The Google definition of a legume is a leguminous plant. So does that help?
What? Ball take. 2-2.
How many leguminous plants have you eaten in your life?
Did I don't care. What?
Got thorns from like 6 of them on our hike today.
Oh my gosh, they're everywhere. So many legumes. Pick back.
What would you say your favorite legume is, now that you think about it?
You know.
That parsley that we weren't supposed to touch on the trail today? I ate like 3 leaves of it.
The Alaskan
Dude,
fire
I've been
water
seeing
legume.
Since 2. I'm going back tomorrow to get more.
2-2. Wide, center field. Costello comes in, gets the first out of the inning.
I don't know if it was parsley or not, but wow.
I'm feeling it.
That's the best few hours of my life. Oh.
No, that was
a number 30, remember. Jackson Sorensen.
Yeah. Sorensen. 0-3 today. Lefty batting 15-43 on the year.
He's due. He's been struggling in the past about 5 at bats or so.
No, Cade Lacey's 2-3 today.
First pitch from Hayes. It's a breaking pitch.
No, that's dude. That's just not what a strike is.
That's not a strike. That was the pitch that Jacob Rebrook got called on.
Geez,
just from the other part of the plate.
That is 3 inches inside. From our angle, everything is altered in that direction. Like that was more inside than it looks to us.
0-1. Bounced away from the catcher, Chavez, and Lacey to second. Rounds looks at third, but Chavez gets it in time.
What's the moniker? What do they say? Was it Gerald Wallace that said it? Who was it that said it? Was it Wallace? Ball don't lie.
Right, I don't know if I believe this, but I just got a text saying that my father got the National Day on the first try.
What?
Three bears and immediately National Porridge.
He thought porridge?
I will say this. Here's the 1-1 pitch to Sorensen. Straight back in the netting.
It's National Porridge Day, and my father got it on the first try. I say as the nurse wheels me to the mental hospital.
I will say, I think the three bears kind of, it means different to us because of the glorious water we have had from them.
Correct. Great water. Good brand.
Good grocery store.
Wherever the rails were, we went off of them.
Yeah, that was, I don't know if we were ever on, I'll be honest.
That's a great point.
1-2, Sorensen into center field. Coming on, Costello. He's going to watch it drop in front of him. Lacey going to third, slide. Safe, ball gets away. Sorensen goes to second. There's runners at second and third with one gone.
Yeah, I, the center fielder, Costello, coming in hard on that ball, couldn't get to it, then wanted to play hero and just spiked the ball right in front of him.
Yeah,
it took
a good five hops
before it got to Forshey at third. Forshey didn't know what to do about it.
Yeah, he just kind of looked at it. Well, the third baseman just put his glove down, but it was too late at that point.
Right.
How about number 27, Zach?
All right.
Thomas.
You're in a good spot in your lineup with Thomas, the four hole up. He's 0 for 2, also has a walk, batting 270 this year. He got two in scoring position. Do something with it.
Infield in here for the Oilers for Mose Hayes. And Thomas watches upstairs.
Blow this thing open, all right?
Getting some extra run support in the top of the seventh is always a good time to add that.
Burt Wells says, Legume chat, best announcers in baseball. Burt, you are.
We love you.
You might be the only one who's in that camp.
Yeah. So Donald Little League in the first Challenger
Legume
League in Alaska
chat.
For individuals with physical and intellectual challenges.
Is there a way we can use Legume chat every day?
Yeah, all right. We can find a way to work Legume into the broadcast. Yesterday was.
Still don't understand what it is, but you know.
Yeah, okay.
Today.
Yeah. Well,
I see. 1-1. Thomas, a good eye there, watches the breaking pitch. It was starting in the strike zone, but
we
put away.
I mentioned it. We have eaten at all of the restaurants open past 10 in this town. It's two of them. So we're going to have to get creative tonight or repeat with Arby's or Pizza Hut.
Send help.
Get a hit here, huh?
2-1.
No.
Nice breaking pitch. I don't know if it was a strike. It was a good break. Home plate umpire says it's caught the zone.
He's done a good job of calling the ball where it crosses the plate today. I'll give him that much. The ball crossed the plate at the numbers.
Sorensen at second. Lacey at third. Thomas watches. It's outside. We'll go full.
Thomas reaches. Pendergast is up. He's 0 for 2 today. Has walked.
He has done pretty well with the bases loaded. Hasn't done anything he's done, but. 3-2. Big swing on the breaking ball from Thomas. Mose Hayes for Zach. And there's two gone. It'll be up to Pendergast to try and get those runners.
How about number six, Alex?
The Oilers have now struck out 5 and walked 6 today. Alex Pendergast at the plate, trying to pull himself out of a hole. Batting average down to 212.
Yeah, he continues to get on base at a high rate, but
oh yeah, OBP's 345 right now.
Swings the first pitch, skies it in a deep center field. Costello runs back, but he gets there in time. Bucs threatening the top of the seventh, but ultimately, no runs come across to score at stretch.
I don't care if I ever get back, let me root, root, root for the home team. If they don't win, it's a shame. Or it's 1-2-3 strikes, you're out at the old ball game.
It was the same tune as Dominic the Donkey. Ever heard that?
No, I've heard this song, but not Dominic the Donkey.
Dominic the Donkey, very similar. Oh, we're back, by the way.
Oh, okay. It's a good way.
Curtis Hebert back on the mound, which is awesome. I like that.
Yeah,
you know,
I was going through the
Bucs stats earlier. Fourth in the league in ERA, 497. 249 opponent batting average. That is fourth in the league as well. Opponent slugging at .325. That is first in the league. Again, the Bucs have only given up one home run this year.
Well, the big thing about Curtis Hebert, I mean, he is the Alaskan Baseball League Shohei Ohtani.
Yes.
Dude can hit for
average. Giving up the Oilers, number 14, Josiah Thomas.
He's done really well on the mound thus far. He'll face 6-7-8 with Josiah Chavez, who's 0 for 2. And is he still above that Mendoza line? He's right at it. 200. He takes the ball.
So I gave you all the pitching stats.
You did.
Told you the dour things. The struggles the Bucs have had.
1-0. So we got a miss from Chavez.
Now it's at the plate where they've been so good. Most runs in the league, most hits in the league by 22, most doubles in the league by 7, most triples in the league by 2, most homers by 3.
1-1, outside.
They have the most total bases by, a cool 52 total bases. They've walked more times than anybody else.
Well, the best part is they're also top in slugging as well.
Yeah.
And that's partially why. That's why those total bases are so high.
Yeah.
These guys hit for power.
They have stolen more bags than anyone else in the ABL. They have the second highest OBP. Second highest batting average. Oilers have a team average of just .236.
3-1. Foul tipped into Burkhalter's mitt. Kent will go full.
Miners have a .214 average. Ooh.
No. But that as their ERA still
six
pretty good?
It's number one in the league. Mm-hmm. The Bucs also lead the league in strikeouts, though. Throw that out there.
Full count. Swing and a miss. Chavez takes the seat as he left his shoes at home plate.
Wow. Good on Hebert to work back for the 3-1. Chavez gave Hebert a little look as he walked back to the dugout. Again, these two teams have had conversations with one another throughout the game.
Last five batters set down in order for the Oilers. First pitch there from Hebert is outside. Hebert set down the last four.
That's what college baseball is, man. I don't like the summer leagues where you show up and everybody is just hands behind their back and timid. And dude, come out here and
fun.
I don't know if show off is the right term, but come out here and bring some swagger to the game. That's what baseball is now. That's what the MLB, dude. They talk, they chatter. Fans are gonna gripe at you.
2-0. That's hit high and deep into left field. Har as it bounce off the base of the wall. Gets it into Pendergast, but sliding in safely with a double as Michael Rada. Going back to your point, I talked to Pendergast about that in the pregame show, and it was more or less, the Bucs like to have fun.
Yeah.
This is a fun team.
Oh, yeah.
They want to come out here. They want to compete. They want to play.
If you don't like the Bucs having fun, that's fine.
Michael Elko.
If you like playing summer baseball that's not fun, then go do that. That's completely fine. The Bucs are going to enjoy themselves.
And they've done that thoroughly. First pitch to the new batter, Elko, is a strike.
Well, both teams are getting the call, so that is good.
Like I said, that one wasn't a strike, but it was called for Bucs.
Yep.
Again.
On a fastball and a breaking ball.
Consistent. That's all you can ask. One. Big hack. Comes up empty. It's 0-2. Rada at second with the double. There's one out in the inning. Hebert trying to strand him there. Should the Oilers get him across, he could cut this lead to one. 0-2. Check on the runner. Inside, almost at the feet of Elko. Again, I don't know why, but I feel like with the Bucs, when they have a two-run lead, it sometimes just feels like more.
Well, I was going to say the same thing. The tying runs at the plate, it doesn't feel like it. I don't know if I like that.
Hebert, 1-2 to Elko. That'll be laced into left center field. Miles Smith on the run. He's not going to get there as it hits the gap. Rounding third and coming home easily is Rada. Smith launches it in. That stops Elko at second. And now the tying run is at second base.
Yeah, good piece of hitting. First run on Hebert's ledger. Second earned run of the game for the Bucs. Hebert has gone 1 1/3. Allowed 2 hits.
Now batting number 1.
Struck out
Brett
3.
Groupie.
Now we've got, looks like maybe some double action going on in the Bucs bullpen. A couple of guys up standing, getting warm, stretching out. One with a ball in the hand. Another guy just picked up a ball. There's movement. Brett Groupie at the plate with a 1-2 day thus far. He's got the tying run at second base. Fastball, good pitch to strike.
Hebert out of Portland. Proud pilot.
Not this summer, though.
True.
Check on the runner at second, 0-1. Breaking pitch right back into the netting.
Now, on this 0-2, especially with the runner at second base, you don't go in the strike zone. Don't go in the strike zone.
Well, and he's hit the outside part of the zone both times. Go a little bit farther. Yeah. You've gotten 2 swings. Just go for it.
Work around. Give him the fastball high and inside. It's my preferred.
Hebert doesn't like the first pitch as he shakes it off. Accepts the second. 0-2. A little early on it
is. Groupie. Jumpin' Junction Family Fun Center.
Fastball.
The whole family. Bounce, mini golf, arcade, and active
fastball
VR.
Inside, but what about the belt? And Groupie was behind on it.
Two. Check on the runner. Chopper. Nice little jump off the mound by Hebert. He'll just flip it to Thomas. Gets the second out of the inning. A very athletic play, but that's from a guy who predominantly plays second base.
Yeah. Leapt up to get it.
Now
we've seen
Hebert
make a couple of spectacular plays at second. Makes a really good play off the mound. But now the tying run is 90 feet away. And what was once a 4-1 lead, now doesn't feel so comfortable.
Yesterday in game 2 of the doubleheader, it was a 5-1 lead that became a 5-5 ball game. First pitch, roller to Sorensen at third. Across the diamond to Thomas in time. Curtis Hebert keeps the lead intact. One does come across. We'll go to the top of the 8th inning. Bucs 4, Oilers 3.
That's when an Oiler hit a double,
Bucs.
And another Oiler right
baseball
after that hit another double. With that being said,
it was time to update the bathroom.
But we didn't want to break the bank.
Rebath made it effortless. A Rebath design consultant came to our home and presented us ideas and products in a way that made our decisions simple.
They took away the old, installed the new, and gave us the bathroom
we've always wanted.
Style affordably. Call 1-844-9-REBATH for your free in-home design consultation today.
Of all the reasons we love Alaska, easy isn't one of them. We like a good challenge, but we also love innovative technology that simplifies our busy lives. Whether you want to make a deposit or pay a bill, check in or check out, or quickly send and receive money, One Bank has the online and mobile tools to help you through whatever comes your way. Simple, secure, reliable. Bank on the go. First National Bank, Alaska.
Arby's new Steakhouse Garlic Ribeye Sandwich. Who knew the best thing to come from a steakhouse wouldn't even come from a steakhouse? Arby's did, that's who. Arby's, we have the meat.
Who sings it? Who sings it?
Neil Diamond, Sweet Caroline. I will say, in the top of the 8th inning, we were at Fenway. Need to go a little bit more in another half inning, get in the middle of the 8th.
Well, yeah.
Leading up to the Bucs, number 9.
We're in Alaska.
Boedeker.
Jace Andrews. Drake Toll.
Is that right? In Fenway, they do it in the middle of the 8th.
Correct.
Okay.
Boedeker, Burkhalter, Hochkuff here in the top of the 8th for the Bucs. That's always what it is, because you have the 7th inning stretch before the Red Sox come up. And in the middle of the 8th, you have Sweet Caroline. Boedeker gets fooled on the breaking pitch there as he shakes his head.
You ever seen it, Sweet Caroline, at Fenway Park?
Yes, I have seen it from the Green Monster.
Hey. Pretty good view up there.
It is.
Student nines, man.
0-1 outside. I think Fenway Park is one of the few baseball parks. And I say a few. Baseball is predominantly a sport where you can get a good seat in just about any part of the ballpark. Yeah. But at Fenway, there is not a single bad seat.
Yeah. I have a good appreciation for, well, you could be right behind a foul pole.
That is the one thing. It was built so long, there are chairs kind of in the way. Boedeker sails that to left field. Backpedaling is Pinkston. And at the very front of the warning track, he makes the catch for out number one.
Yeah, I have an appreciation for stadiums like Fenway, but I can also appreciate a Rangers game in the New Globe Life.
Well, I appreciate the roof on there, too.
You got the big beer bats for like $26.
You had one?
Yeah.
Yeah.
They only have Michelob Ultra, though.
I was born in Texas. You've been in Texas for the past 4 years.
Yeah.
What do you think the best place to go watch a sporting event in Texas is?
That's a great question.
Pro teams. I'll go with pro.
Oh.
Cut and a miss from Burkhalter.
I would say all sport. It would be Gregory Gymnasium, the University of Texas volleyball venue. One of the rowdiest atmospheres that I've seen. It's Burkhalter 0-3 today, looking for his
volleyball
first.
Volleyball gets rowdy.
Yeah.
People are into that.
Oh! That was called strike. Okay. All right. Sorry, Trent. Sorry about your bad luck. Swing the bat, I guess.
Gonna have to here with 0-2. Gotta protect. Hocuff on deck. Only guaranteed batter left. Burkhalter foul tips it. We're in the top of the eighth, and the Bucs only up by one. Really would like some breathing room going into the bottom of the eighth and the bottom of the ninth.
Yeah.
Looks like we have a Buck pitcher warming in the bullpen. Well, he stopped now, I think. We had somebody. 0-2. Outside.
Yep.
It's a good call there.
Yep. I mean, we've seen it called a strike, but that is outside, yeah.
Chavez tried to frame it, but I think that made it more obvious.
Yeah. Mose Hayes has been pretty good. Stands at just 5'7". 180 pounds.
1-2. That's a breaking pitch that almost hits Burkhalter. He stands a lot higher on that mound, though. That's it. Again, we've mentioned a lot, but that's a tall mound.
Yeah.
Come down with some force. Shoot two. Laced to the third baseman on a hop. Forche across the diamond to first pick by the first baseman, Rada. Forche and Rada combined for a good play. There's two outs.
That was really good. Really good glove by Forche to get the screamer. And then I say it even better throw. It was a solid throw.
Number 17, Logan Burkhalter.
Batting average now down to 314. Started at 354 today. As Logan Hocup comes to the plate, he has gotten a hit, come around to score a run as well.
Two outs for Hocup. In the left center field, looping, but Costello in time reaches it for out number three. Bottom of the eighth, Bucs lead by one. It'll be Curtis Saber here in the bottom of the eighth once again on the Anchorage Bucs Baseball Network.
Of all the reasons we love Alaska, easy isn't one of them. We like a good challenge, but we also love innovative technology that simplifies our busy lives. Whether you want to make a deposit or pay a bill, check in or check out, or quickly send and receive money, One Bank has the online and mobile tools to help you through whatever comes your way. Simple, secure, reliable. Bank on the go. First National Bank, Alaska.
Boar's Head has harnessed the power of fire to unlock an intense new flavor. An expertly charred, flame-grilled masterpiece to take your senses to new heights. Because when Boar's Head lights a fire, we ignite an experience worth savoring. New Boar's Head Firesmith Flame Grilled Chicken Breast. Flavor forged in flame. Available only at the deli and only from Boar's Head. Compromise elsewhere.
Curtis
to St. Mary, back of the mound, the bottom of the eighth. Bucs with a one-run lead on the Anchorage Bucs Baseball Network. Jace Andrews alongside Drake Toll and Harper Mayfield, our social media director. If you enjoy social media, thank Harper.
Yeah. A-Bear back out on the mound. He's been solid. Two innings, has allowed two hits, one earned run, but struck out three in the eight batters that he's faced.
Hitting off the Oilers, number two, Kirby Pinkston.
Should be Pinkston with the one to get it off here for A-Bear as he goes into his third inning of work. First pitch is a ball way outside. A-Bear, past year at the University of Portland. Not the greatest ERA as it was just over 17. 0-4 record.
True.
Appearances, three starts. And 12.2 innings pitched. Another pitch in the same place, that's ball two. But the opponent batting average at 288 is not terrible.
Yeah, no.
Not the worst. 2-0.
You know, I barely threw it even in high school. My baseball career didn't take me very far, that's why I'm in the booth. But I did like... when I had a good inning or gotten on a roll, when I get to come out quickly.
That's a strike inside.
To say that, A-Bear did not get a lot of time. It was a quick three up and three down in the top of the eighth, and he was right back out. But it seemed like he had some momentum. I was hoping that would build, but started out 3-0, and now a hitter's count.
Outside. All four. Five-pitch walk to start the inning. And I think that's, again, that's why sometimes when there's a big, long inning, the pitchers come out there and give up runs right away because they've been sitting for so long.
Right. I always enjoyed that. Look, if
I went 15, out Ben Griffin.
And was feeling good, or set a couple guys down, I don't need time. I want to be right back out there. Come on.
Runner at first. He's the tying run. Go ahead, run at the plate, and Ben Griffin, he looks to bunt, pulls back. It's outside.
I'm sure a lot of pitchers would agree. I mean, it's all you think about. As much as you want your team to score runs, you're just thinking about getting back out on the rubber and what your next half inning looks like. There's a job to do.
A-Bear checks the runner. Pitch to Griffin. He looks to bunt again. Again, a ball. 2-0.
And a free pass here. Bucs will likely go to the pen.
A-Bear's going to rub the ball clean here, maybe get a better grip on it.
I don't know if he's cleaning it.
Rubbing it off, getting some nice grip.
Putting some better dirt, yep.
Let's get some grip.
A little spit, a little dirt.
Pinkston at first. Bunt put on again. That just missed.
Didn't miss by much.
Now 3-0 to Griffin. We'll see if the bunt is still on. I think he'll be watching all the way on this one.
Yeah, oh, yeah. Definitely a red light.
He may throw the bunt out there just to try and trick. He does. He pulls back. It's a strike. Kind of getting ahead of A-Bear there.
Yeah. I always like that. Thanks for the extra target.
3-1 from Big Kurt.
God bless, dude.
Again, it just goes right to the hole.
I promised you. That they don't have netting there, so it hits the bar, and that ball is about 4 feet away from coming right through this window in front of us and hitting either one of us. It's the most dangerous thing you can do in a ballpark.
That's not safe.
Oh.
Least left field. Har makes the grab.
Great play. Good range from Har. And A-Bear worked himself back from 3-0. It's like a pitching machine. You know, you drop a ball in the pitching machine, and it just shoots it out. That's what that is. Somebody fouls a ball off up past the net, hits the iron bar, and it's going anywhere in this ballpark. You have no idea.
And it's happened twice in this game, so you know that's happened before.
That one I deserve to flinch.
Oh, 100%.
The ball was almost through our window.
When the ball hits something and then goes a different direction, flinching is on the table because you don't know where that's going at all.
Out goes Kenny Barton, and that'll...
That's not...
Mitchell Griggs,
there you go.
It looked the exact same. That'll bring a pitching change.
Well, yes, sir.
And I think, who's that?
Oliver?
Well, we'll find out when we come back here on the Anchorage Bucs Baseball Network.
Arby's new Steakhouse Garlic Ribeye Sandwich. Who knew the best thing?
Keep on sunny side, always on sunny side.
Come into Village Inn and see why the sun rises and sets with breakfast.
It will help us every day, it will brighten all the way, if we keep on sunny side of life.
Because a good meal is about more than just how it tastes. It's about how it makes you feel.
Keep on sunny side, always on sunny side. Keep on sunny side of life.
Village Inn.
Qdoba's new Chicken Diablo Nachos are made with hand-diced pico de gallo, which means they're as fresh as... They're also loaded with juicy adobo chicken, flame-grilled in-house, so they're as flavorful as... And they're topped off with fiery queso Diablo, so they're as spicy as... New Chicken Diablo Nachos. Try them today, only at Qdoba. United by flavor.
Curtis Hebert out, Oliver Brown in. Hebert, 2 1/3, 2 hits, 1 run it was earned, 1 walk, 3 strikeouts. Oliver Brown making his second appearance in this series. He pitched just 2 days ago against these Oilers.
Yeah, there's a struggle with having a doubleheader here and playing 5 games in 4 days. And it means that if you got a guy who goes in game one, who's still got some juice left in the tank, he only faced 11 batters, went 2 1/3, allowed 2 hits, 2 walks, also had a strikeout in the 5-1 loss in game one. And he's right back out here on a mound. He's already thrown on this week. With a runner at first base and one down, the go-ahead run at the plate. Brown out of Holy Cross, 6 foot, 180-pound freshman. Has pitched 3 times in the ABL, has a 4.50 ERA, has 1 start to his name. 3 games, in 3 games he's pitched, 8 innings, 9 strikeouts, 3 walks, 10 hits.
How about it, number 26, Nick Costello.
Costello will be the one to bring him, as it'll be 1 for 3 day for Costello. Pretty good batting average, came in here hitting .473, dropped that to .455 today. Runner at first is a tying run. Costello, the go-ahead run at the bottom of the eighth for Brown. He looks to bunt, he pulls back, it's a ball, and it's gonna be Burkhalter. It was under the legs of the umpire. Umpire backed away.
That's a strong word. Yeah. He really didn't, he just kinda stood there.
Stood over top of it.
So Burkhalter's
pushed him in a way.
Gonna get a new baseball and have a small conversation. Hey, if you could just please get out of the way of the baseball, that would be appreciated.
Yeah, I mean,
he just kept stepping on it.
If you're a catcher, every time you go out there and tell an umpire, just literally run away.
Yeah.
Just go away.
Dude was slow rolling, kicking the baseball backwards.
1-0 with one out in the inning. Again, looking to bunt, pulls back. It's a strike this time.
Good pitch from Brown. Fastball, inner half.
1 ball, 1 strike, 1 out, 1 runner on. In a 1-run game here in the bottom of the eighth. Nick Costello with a 1 for 3 day. Will he bunt again? 1-1. He will not. Big swing, big miss.
He wasn't close to that baseball.
Not even. Brown checks the runner at first. That's Pinkston. Looking for the K. Runner takes off. It's going to be a fair ball down the right field line on a rope from Costello. Boedeker throws it in. Holds him to a single, but there's runners on the corners, and the tying run is 90 feet away.
Bucs already have one double play today. Can Brown get another one from Forshee here? Costello now 2 for 4.
How about number 17? Forshee.
Reached on an error in the first. Singled in the third. Struck out in the fourth.
Costello's average now .478. Tying run at third. Bucs have just 3 hits today. Offense has not been the story for this team
gotten some help from the Oilers pitching staff. Forshey watches the first pitch low.
Yep.
Well, three of those four runs were gifts, a hit by pitch, and a couple of walks with the bases loaded. Boedeker had the sack fly, and that's really the only thing that the Bucs have done themselves in a way. I mean, obviously they've worked good counts and been able to get into those positions, but
yeah.
Seven hits compared to three is not something we're used to see.
Right. Costello goes. Really like the idea of running either Pendergast or Hocuff in front of the bag. Throw down to either. Make Pinkston think you're going to second base. And as he tries to get home, dial it right back to Burkhalter.
Flies. Left field, Haar. Under it. Pinkston looking to tag. The throw from Haar. Sliding in. Is he safe? He is. Burkhalter thought he got a tag. Burkhalter mounts that so bad. He thought he got him.
Oliver Brown unhappy. Here comes Kenny Barton, and they've got a 100%. They've gotten such a good point.
I don't think he could tag them. I don't know if he tagged home. Because he slid and went
around
the bag.
He went around the bag. He took the furthest possible route to home plate. The furthest possible route. Burkhalter was upset, and we know Burkhalter. He does not get upset easily.
Well, Burkhalter, he'll shoot you straight. He knows exactly when an umpire is right and wrong. And there are multiple times where he has been, you know what? It hurts me, but that's a good call.
Brother.
Because he's a catcher.
He's a catcher. 14, Josiah Chavez.
Are we shocked by anything that just happened?
Not
let's,
at all.
Let's take a second here. Not are we shocked by anything that just happened?
Not at all.
Okay.
Now the go-ahead run is at second base.
Like if we set our expectations appropriately.
Yeah. Chavez, who is 0 for 3 at the plate. He watches the first pitch away.
A close play.
Very close.
I think he's safe no matter what if he doesn't take.
No, it was just a bad slide.
Three steps to, yeah, oh, it's terrible.
Bad. To be honest, that backhand was the only part that could have even touched the plate at all.
Yeah, I don't know why he decided to run into home plate like that.
Strike on the foul tip from
go ahead, run in scoring position, too. I wish we had a budget, man, like just a big budget for a multi-camera setup. We could see that play close.
That would be
I'd
nice.
Probably be more upset than I am now, though.
Oh,
if I could watch it in slow-mo.
1-1 inside. Just well, the biggest thing, though, is it'd give us clarity to see if that was actually the right call.
It would, but then I'd
from
be
our
screaming
eyes,
in the void.
Correct. From our eyes, it was not. And if we were proved right, then that just makes it more frustrating.
Look, I've been here for 3 weeks. Nothing can hurt me now.
Yeah, we've gotten the expectation.
Nothing can hurt me now.
2-1. Skied on the infield. Sorensen right at the third base bag. Grabs it. We're tied. 4-4. It's a one-inning game now as we're in the top of the ninth coming up for the Bucs. In the top of the ninth. 9-1-2 as it'll be Haar, Lacey, and Smith on the Anchorage Bucs Baseball Network.
They call him the harder farmer, a real bad man with a soft side for hard lemonade. He's got a nose for lemons and for trouble. This time he's back with half tea, half lemonade, and 100% oh wow.
Oh wow!
Get your hands on some today before the harder farmer gets his hands on you.
When Subway opened, they changed the fast food game. But sometimes you gotta refresh to be fresh. Welcome to the Eat Fresh Refresh, where there's so much new, some say it can't fit in one ad. I say, we're talking a new All-American Club, deli-style oven-roasted turkey, and...
Oh, that's a new steak and cheese.
Oh, yeah, I knew that. That's the one with the new seasoning.
And that was the new MVP Parmesan vinaigrette.
Right, which makes a next-level foot... Hold up, Subway's over? Wait, I'm out of time.
It was a 5-1 game yesterday. The Oilers stormed back to make it 5-5, but the Bucs ended up walking it off somehow in sudden death. Now it was 4-1. The Bucs have given up that lead, and we're tied 4-4. It's Connor Thronberry back on the mound. He'll face the Bucs for the now fifth time this season. Drake, Thronberry season stats.
Thronberry is 0-2 this year, 1.28 ERA, 6 appearances, this being his 7th, also has 1 start. couple of saves this year, 14 innings pitched, 19 strikeouts, 7 walks, 10 hits. He also pitched on June 21st, which was Wednesday.
Just like Oliver Brown.
He went 4 innings, though. Like Oliver Brown.
That is different.
I mean, Penn State product.
He's thrown a bunch this summer. It's early, too.
I'm a little confused. I guess the pitching staff's just that thin for them. Right, let's look at the pitch count for him.
53.
Oh, my gosh.
Good grief.
This kid gets one day rest after throwing 53 pitches.
Again, that's a starter number right there.
I'm not. You know, I don't want to give too much commentary, although that is
it's your job.
Our job is labeled
that is,
as.
That is what we were doing.
I'm a college baseball coach. If I'm Connor Thornberry's coach at Penn State and he threw 53 pitches, gets 2 nights rest, and then throws again. Like, this is not Omaha.
And here's the thing. When he threw, that was like 10 o'clock, too, because of the delay.
Yeah.
So it's not even 48 hours.
I don't.
Har watches the first pitch. It's a fastball upstairs for ball one.
I don't want to add any inappropriate commentary, but dude, this poor kid.
1-0. That's inside.
Not only that, this is now his 7th appearance.
Yeah, I mean he's had one appearance at Notkins. I mean, hold on, let's go here. The 7th, the 8th, the 11th, the 14th, the 16th, the 21st, and now the 23rd.
Yeah.
2-0. That's inside.
Yeah, you want innings? Connor Thornberry gets innings. Well, and he's pitched. That 4-inning mark is tied for the most he's pitched all year. And he gets one day to ice his arm, and he's right back out.
3-0 to Har. Pulls back. It's a strike. I don't know about that one.
No. We can't be gifting strike one on 3-0 counts.
3-1 from Thornberry. The hitters count, and it's ball 4. That was kind of in the same exact area. That one may have actually been a strike. Either way, that's going to be ball 4, and we have a runner on in the top of the 9th for the Bucs.
I am truly, truly dumbfounded.
Now batting number 20, Cade Lacy.
Now it's Cade Lacy. He's 2-for-3.
Credit to Connor Thornberry for a very good 3-1 pitch. I don't know, man. It's awesome. Bucs are back at the top of the lineup.
Second best batting average on the team, Lacy. It's a breaking pitch. Curveball's in there.
Lacy 2-for-3 today.
Oilers.
With a walk as well.
Have the third baseman, Forshay, in, maybe watching the bunt. On the other hand, Lacy can pull it down the line. Oh. 1. Lacy over the head on the left side. Base hit number 3 on the day. Runners at first and second. Nobody out. And Lacy just continues to rake.
Followed up by Miles Smith, who is 1-for-2 today, has also walked. Batting 313 now, had a really good series up here on the peninsula. Huh. Will they walk him?
Number 23.
Smith got Miles his first RBI Smith. Earlier in this game.
Dude, I can't keep taking these games that are. These are.
Smith has got some speed, too.
The heart pill games, dude. Let's just win by a lot.
Both corners in. He is going to bunt. And he just fouls it off.
Yeah. Good pitch from Thornberry. Good breaker.
With Smith's speed, I think the bunt is the right idea here because at worst, you're moving the runners up with one out.
Well, more importantly than Smith's speed, it's Har's speed.
That's true, and he'll get the third.
That's what
Lacy's
you need.
Lacy's also fast.
That's what you need.
You got some speed all around the bases here.
Those are your 2 leadoff guys.
0-1 here to Smith. Looks to bunt again. Pulls back. It's low. Block at the plate by Chavez.
One of the best ways to tell who's comfortable bunting, how smooth do they look when they pull the bat back. You can tell. Miles Smith has done that a lot.
1 ball, 1 strike.
He sees everything so well. It's like the game slowed down for him.
Bunts it. And this time he misses it, but he missed it so bad that it just bounced off the catcher. Both runs move up. Well, you take that. I mean, that's not exactly what you wanted, but it works. Wow. Now you got runners at second and third with nobody out, and Smith not done yet. He's got a 1-2 count, but he's still at the plate.
Well, the Bucs can't walk it off tonight. They can't walk it off here. But now Smith with the base hit would give the Bucs a 2-run lead in what is a tie game.
1 ball and 2 strikes. The infield is in for the Oilers. Thornberry on the mound. Miles Smith at the plate. 1-2. That's a chopper. Throneberry looks at the runner of the third, toss in time.
So here's what happened. I know we're not supposed to play the game of what ifs, but that's just baseball. Smith bunted the ball, was thrown out at first. Both the runners advanced to second and third. That's what you wanted the whole time, right?
That's exactly what happened.
That's what you wanted the whole time.
In a very odd way, it worked.
Jackson Sorensen 1-for-4 today. Zach Thomas 0-for-3 behind him. Pendergast 0-for-3 behind Thomas.
When Sorensen was at the plate last night with a chance to walk it off himself, luckily the Bucs came in clutch with Alex Pendergast getting the walk. But I guarantee he wants to get a knock here. Up the middle, base hit. Infield was in. Benhar comes racing home. Lacey right behind him. He's going to slide in safe. The ball gets away from the catcher. It's a 2-RBI single for Sorensen. 6-4 Bucs in the top of the ninth.
Great piece of hitting on the first pitch that Sorensen gets, and he rips it right back up the middle. Last night, he strikes out with the bases loaded and a chance to win it. Tonight, he gets redemption. Something about the Bucs at ninth innings at Coral Seymour Ballpark.
The Bucs, baby. It's all about the Bucs. And they're up by 2. 5 hits now. 2 of those this inning. Now it's Thomas trying to grab some extra insurance.
So what do? You bring Oliver Brown back out, yeah?
Yeah.
There's some action in the pen.
I think you let Oliver get out there, see what he's got.
Yeah.
Strike taking the breaking pitch.
Burt Wells says that is hitting, and Burt's got a point.
He does.
People are not talking about that enough.
Check swing, he went across.
Yeah, that's a good call. That's the right call.
That is. Nobody talks about that. Not enough. 1-2. Thomas chops it foul.
Told you Thomas is 0-for-3 today.
Marcus King, black and gold. Yes, sir.
Does have an RBI. Couple of strikeouts. 263 batting average this year. Came in batting 285.
Blocked by Chavez at the plate. 2-2. Keeps the runner Sorensen at first. And again, we talked about it. Sorensen, or rather, Thornberry, he's faced these Bucs a lot. Soon enough, they're going to find the way.
Oh, yeah.
2-2. Just off the end of the bat there.
It's pretty unbelievable how many times Thornberry has pitched already against the. We are not halfway into this season. He's gone out 5 times against the Bucs.
2-2. Breaking pitch up high.
Of the 14 innings that Thornberry has pitched, 10 of them have come against the Anchorage Bucs. Well, now 10 and a third.
Outside, no. No.
What?
Strike 3 to Thomas.
I don't know why. I don't know why I have hope.
Why are we surprised?
I don't know why I have hope.
Number 6, Alex Pendergast.
Every time I think maybe, just maybe, this is the time where everything works out.
Pendergast with a walk today. So did we ever figure out what his on-base streak was?
I don't know.
It doesn't really matter right now. Watch the strike.
I don't know, man. I just, you know. Like Zach Thomas just struck out. I don't know. The dude doesn't deserve a strikeout in the stat book.
1. Outside.
That's why we need robot umpires. In summer league baseball, give me robot umpires. So that when colleges look at kids in the portal or whatever, who's going to start the next spring, who had a great summer.
Pendergast fouls it off.
Then they get accurate numbers.
Wild Bill and Angie Simpson.
Drake, what that hit?
What hit? White Nissan Maxima, Arkansas plates. Kind of uncanny how many times that car's been pegged this year.
It's a magnet. 1-2. Good eye and a stolen base for Sorensen as he took off.
Sorensen's the fastest player on this team. Why'd you laugh? Because it's not true.
Well, now a base hit, you could score him. He'll be off on the crack of the bat. 1-2. 2 outs. Pendergast. Texas leaguer. No, that's a little farther. It goes to the right to the center fielder in Costello. Bucs get 2 on the RBI single from Jackson Sorensen.
And now, bottom ninth, 7-8-9, the bottom part of the order for the Oilers on the Anchorage Bucs Baseball Network.
We are a family business serving Alaskans for over 60 years. Our founder is my dad, Herb Ekman, a German immigrant who started the business in 1963 with his good friend, Otto. To this day, the business is dedicated to making products that are distinctive and of the highest quality.
When Arby's added bacon to the Wagyu Steakhouse burger, it was like, not bad. Then Arby's grabbed that peppercorn ranch and has never felt more alive. Arby's, we have the meat.
In 1986, we started the Alaskan Brewing Company. And so we've always tried to reflect the quality that the state has in the beers that we make.
Alaska's beautiful, it's true, it's real.
For 30 years, we've been trying to capture the nature of Alaska and put it in a bottle. Today, 30 years later, we're still making beer in the last frontier.
Welcome back here to the Anchorage Bucs Baseball Network. Jace Andrews, Drake Toll,
leading
7-8-9 for the Oilers in the bottom.
Number 11, Michael Rada.
Started off, followed up by Michael Upko and Brett Groupie. We're all due up. And it's Oliver Brown back on the mound here.
Have one here, Ollie.
Breaking pitch is low.
The big O, Oliver Brown. Who was the big O, do you know?
Georges.
Would be Oliver Miller, University of Arkansas basketball, early 90s. That was around for it.
Two O.
Just a clean three up, three down. That's probably too much to ask, yes?
Probably.
Against 7-8-9.
The Bucs have been notorious to make every game.
Yep.
As tough as it can be on themselves sometimes.
The Bucs have yet to climb two games above 500 this season.
Well,
Anchorage
what
could,
did you know?
Could reasonably, they're in a very good position to leave the Peninsula as the number one team in the league.
3-0 inside. Lead off walk for Brown. There is a Buc warming in the bullpen. Can't see who it is, but I'm sure he's warming with a little bit of haste.
A double play here would be the coolest thing ever. Elko 1-for-3 today with 2 RBI, batting 163 this year.
From our social media director, Robert Mayfield, it is Cade Wiegert, what we can see.
Hard
not batting for the Oilers, number 12, Michael Elko.
Wiegert tops out at 96.
Elko 1-for-3. 163 average. He has two ribbies today. Watches a strike outside park.
Both these dugouts getting into it.
Michael Elko out of Northwestern, one of three Northwestern players in the starting lineup. The one outside.
I haven't talked about it much, but Trenton Burkhalter has been just a brick wall behind the plate today. He's
been amazing.
So good.
Has anybody tried to steal him?
I don't think so. He's fun to watch, man.
1-1. On the ground to Pendergast. 4-6-3, but they're going to say the runner at second base is safe because Hocuff's foot came off the bag early. And Hocuff just gets the wave of the hand from the umpire.
What did you see on that, partner?
I thought his foot was there. He grabbed and pushed at the same time. Bishop Griggs gonna come out.
I don't
you
know.
You can at least ask for a meeting here.
Yeah, I don't know if the third base umpire has warned Logan Hoke, and he's warned Bishop Griggs.
What are we doing?
Bishop Griggs is trying to visit his pitcher, and the third base umpire just gave Griggs no reason.
Literally no reason.
Bishop
at all.
Griggs says, "Dude, I'm not even talking to you. Let's go to the pen." Oh my brother,
Cade Wiegert. looking to come in here for the Bucs. There's a runner at second with one gone on the Anchorage Bucs Baseball Network. We'll take a break.
Boar's Head has harnessed the power of fire to unlock an intense new flavor. An expertly charred, flame-grilled masterpiece to take your senses to new heights. Because when Boar's Head lights a fire, we ignite an experience worth savoring. New Boar's Head Firesmith Flame-Grilled Chicken Breast. Flavor forged in flame. Available only at the deli and only from Boar's Head. Compromise elsewhere.
If there's one thing I've learned at Speedy Glass, it's that every chip becomes a crack. Today, I'm gonna show you why. When we look at a chip up close, we see tons of tiny cracks that are just waiting to spread. Don't wait for your chip to crack. Repair it at Speedy Glass before having to replace the entire windshield. You'll save time. You'll be back on the road within an hour. Book an appointment at speedyglass.ca.
Speedy Glass Repair. Speedy Glass Replace.
Welcome back. There's a runner at second base as Cade Wiegert steps on the mound. He's going to get the last two outs and a save and get the Bucs out here with a series victory in hands before tomorrow's series cap.
Pitch running at second base, number 13, Leighton
Humphrey. Pitched on June 21st, a couple of days ago, went two-thirds of an inning, walked two. That was it. Faced four batters.
We got a pinch runner at second base. It's Leighton Humphrey.
Yeah. Wiegert tops out at 96, the fastball. Can shut the door here. And I think, you know, we've spent a good amount of tonight's game talking about the umpires and talking about how that feeds into gameplay, because that is something that is, look, you're not in the ballpark, you're watching from home, here's what's happening, that's what's going on at Coral Seymour, and the guy on third is the same, he looks like it, the same home plate umpire from last night, and things got kind of personal. Like, it's not that deep in Summer League Baseball. I just don't know. I don't know why things have had to escalate so fast here.
Logan Hillcuff has a warning, according to the finger point, Bishop Griggs does too for walking up to the mound.
What you saw is the umpire pointed at Griggs like he was giving him a warning, and Griggs just looked confused. Like, dude, I'm trying to take my pitcher out. What do you want from me? Like, it's just calm down, everybody.
Groupie at the plate. Wiegert on the mound. First pitch is a fastball away.
Frustrating for these guys to have to deal with, you know, these players, that is.
Groupie right at the Mendoza line, 200.
Let's get a couple outs here, go home, see you again tomorrow. What do you say?
One for three on the day. Helfrick at second. Inside.
Didn't miss by much.
Maybe didn't miss by all. Wiegert trying to get back in the strike zone here with a 2-0 pitch. Does not find it. Real. Tying run is at home plate in Groupie. Technically, the run at second base means nothing.
Yeah.
Groupie, the 9 slotted. We go back to the top of the order with McElfetrick, Pinkston, and Griffin. Rio, strike.
He is known, our home plate umpire friend, to being very kind on 3-0.
He is. He gives the benefit of the doubt a lot.
Such was the case there. That's ball four.
Time called. We are going to reset here. And just to recap, we thought we had a double play. It was a 4-6-3 ground out, but third base umpire now said that Hillcuff's foot was off the bag. 3-1. Skied into center field, dropping fast. Miles Smith gets there in time, and there's two gone. The speedy
Miles Smith.
Look, you got a lot of really good outfielders on this team. Nobody on this roster makes the play like Miles Smith did right there.
That was with the breeze, and that was a tough play.
There,
I was a little blooper going
in. There are a lot of guys.
In.
I'd say the majority of the guys probably don't get there.
How about number three, Owen McElfiltrick?
This team's full of elite outfielders, but the range of Miles Smith, he showed it there. That ball is 25 feet off the infield grass. He's the only one with a play on it and gets there in plenty of time.
There's two outs now. Wiegert, one out from the save.
Wiegert, 3-0 and worked back.
McElfiltrick takes a strike.
Bucs could clinch the series here, winning three of the first four.
They'd go over 500 by two games for the first time this season.
Moving to 6-1 against the Oilers with a win.
The 0-1 to McElfiltrick from Wiegert. Way above his head, it gets away from Burkhalter, and then Helfrich's gonna go to third, looked at home. Just slipped out of the hand of Wiegert. Again, that run is just at third. It's just gonna be the fifth run. Tying run is what matters at home plate. One ball and one strike. Wiegert looks in, the pitch outside.
Tight breaking ball. You gotta bring that in about 6 inches closer to the plate to make it competitive.
Two balls, one strike, two outs. Wiegert from the windup. Swing and a miss for McElfiltrick. It's 2-2.
Good cheese. 95 from Wiegert.
I say go back to it.
Strike
it
away. Yep.
Way
that's your pitch.
Two balls, two strikes, two outs. 6-4 Bucs going for the win with this pitch with Wiegert from the windup. Skied foul out of play.
Foul ball brought to you by Dennis and Kristen Mellinger.
Another high-pressure situation for the Bucs.
Two-two with two outs once again. Wiegert trying to earn the save. Just outside, the Bucs dugout was ready to empty and go out.
That was awesome. The Bucs dugout starts clearing because it was strike three, by the way, and the Oiler fans thought it was the funniest thing in the world. They all yelled right back at him. I mean, he just got a big chuckle out of it.
Three
hey,
balls.
What do you say we call strikes?
Three balls, two strikes, two outs. The pitch from Wiegert. Up high, ball four. Runners on the corners. The tying run is now at base. On base, Drewby Pinkston. The go-ahead runs up home plate. He's actually the winning runner.
Pressure Kirby
pitches for
Cade
Wiegert. Came in here and got the first out on a nice play by Miles Smith.
Pinkston
wild pitch, move one, run over. And now you have a walk with the corners.
Pinkston 0 for 3. Represents the game-winning run, though.
First pitch inside.
These fans are unforgiving to Wiegert.
Bucs at the top step of the dugout. Check on the runner. 1-0. Strike. Bottom part of the zone. 1-1. Jeremy Pinkston, again, does not have a hit today. And now we're going to have a little sign here from Burkhalter in case the runner at first takes off. It's McElfiltrick.
Bucs against everybody right now.
One ball and one strike. Wiegert accepts the first pitch from Burkhalter. Check on the runner. He goes. Up the middle. Hoka has to go back. He dives and stops it. Throw to first from his knees. Not in time. Runner comes across to score. An athletic play to keep that in front of him. Almost had it. But the hit and run works as it just gets Hoka in the wrong position for that. And now the tying runs at second base. And it's 6-5.
Hoka looks a little banged up right now. Kenny Barton's going to come talk to him. all of the credit in the world to Logan Hocup, who is running over to cover second base. So that ball is hit behind him. He's got to dive backwards to glove it and just stops the ball. If that ball goes under his glove, the game-tying run is 90 feet away. Logan Hocup, if the Bucs win this game, that play's huge. It's an infield hit. That is it's ball game. If the runner doesn't go, that's right to Hocup. Flip to second base. We'll see tomorrow. But Hocup coming over to cover the bag.
Ben Griffin will be at the plate.
Now batting for the Oilers, number 15, Ben Griffin.
0-4 today, batting 300.
That run. Charge. Brown. Close the book on him. Wiegert here. Now has the tying run at second, winning run at first, and Ben Griffin at the plate, who is 0-4. Wiegert's first pitch. Up high.
Righty, righty. Oh, Wiegert offered strike three earlier, just couldn't get the call.
Bucs dugout was halfway cleared.
Yep, they're ready to go home.
Wiegert's 1-0. Long look in. Inside. Ball gets away, it goes right to Pendergast.
And there's the Oilers dugout screaming at him. Hey, where's their warning? You had to warn the Anchorage Bucs earlier today, and now the Oilers can do whatever they want, huh?
Maybe Kenny Barton has to go talk to him.
I don't understand. I just don't get it. You warned the Bucs dugout in the first inning of this game. But everybody else, it's a free game. Thanks, John.
2-0. Strike inside, part of the plate. 2-1. That's a great pitch right there to get back in.
I like the Bucs dugout decision to be the bigger people. Be the bigger guy.
Wiegert on the mound here with a 2-1 count. Tying run at second, go-ahead run, winning run at first. Inside, almost hits the batter, Griffin. 3-1.
Oh, it's Wiegert's game. Everybody is cleared out of the bullpen for the Bucs. It is Wiegert's game. And a hitter's count to Griffin. A base hit would tie it.
Wiegert looks into Burkhalter, gets the sign. A 3-1 to Griffin. Ball four. Bases are loaded for Nick Costello, who is 2-for-4 and leads the team in average. And Bishop coming out here talking. He's going to go have a mound visit here with Cade Wiegert.
I had to ask permission of the umpire. Can I go talk to my pitcher without getting a warning? Home plate blue says yes.
And he hasn't been the one to give out warnings. It's been that third place umpire.
Wiegert has gotten one out. He has allowed a hit, and he's walked two. You got to be in the zone. I mean, you got to be in the zone. You know, you. And that's what Bishop Greg, that's the last thing he's saying is, hey, you got to be in the zone. That's not what you want. That's not what you want to say to the kid who can't seem to find control right now.
Instead, number 26.
Hey, focus
Nick
and do what you do.
Costello!
Focus and do what you do. The strikes come.
Deep breath for Wiegert here. An Oiler on every base. And it's Nick Costello with a .478 average coming to the plate. Batting from the left-hand side. First pitch. Fastball strike. Early strike is good there for Wiegert. Want to stay in the zone as much as possible. Miguel Fetrick at third. Pinkston at second. Griffin at first. Griffin doesn't really matter as Miguel Fetrick's the tying run. Pinkston's the winning run. 0-1 from Wiegert. That's a strike.
100%.
0-2.
Boy, it's silent. The ballpark now.
Bases loaded.
Don't throw it away from Burkhalter.
Nick Costello at the plate.
You don't have to go in the zone. Don't throw it away from Burkhalter.
Wiegert on the mound. Here it comes. Strike three! Nick Costello swings right through the pitch, and Cade Wiegert works the save, and the Bucs win the series. They're two games over 500 for the first time this year. What a game.
Hey, we'll have to see you later. To all the fans that were chirping, thank you.
Oilers
it's been a pleasure.
For
the Oilers dugout, I personally have very much enjoyed this game.
At 6 p.m. For
the umpiring crew,
PayPal's
you guys were solid,
park.
And the Bucs win. Look, if it's got to be the world against the Bucs, I want the Bucs. You better help the world because those guys are hot right now. They've now taken three out of the last four of the Peninsula, and ice in his veins. Wiegert. Three-pitch strikeout to the team leader in batting average,
who was 2-for-4 today.
And we'll just have to see tomorrow. We'll just have to see you later. We're just going to have to say this game's over and the Bucs win. That's just what we're going to have to do.
Have fun.
We're going to have to call it here, and we'll see you guys tomorrow.
Bucs win, 6-5. The Bucs, baby.
For the Bucs tonight, 6 runs, 7 hits, 1 error. Oilers, 5 runs, 8 hits, 1 error. The bases left stranded. When the Oilers had another opportunity, 2 nights in a row.
They did.
3 games in a row. 3 one-run games.
I was about to say, this has all been a great series.
The Bucs have won 3 straight now. And look, the fans getting chirpy, the dugout getting chirpy. That's when you want to win.
And the Bucs got a warning in the first inning.
How do you talk back? You just win. How do you respond? You just win. And that's what the Bucs have done in this series. They have not let it get to them. They have just one, and that goes so far. This team was great tonight. Multiple base hits from Cade Lacy. He finishes 3-for-4. Jackson Sorensen goes 2-for-5 with a 2 RBI single that gives
game
the Bucs
winner.
A 6-4 lead. Ends up being the game winner. RBI as well from Zach Thomas, Alex Pendergast, Lex Boedeker. It was a true team effort tonight with Jackson Sorensen being the icing on the cake.
One to top it off, Sky Wells, pretty good outing. 5 innings pitched, 4 hits, just giving up 2 runs. Only one of those earned. Hebert comes in, 2 1/3. Does give up 2 runs, but only on 2 hits. Oliver Brown, nice 1 inning. And then Wiegert shuts the door in a high-stress situation.
Wiegert did not have a great outing. Wiegert struggled with control in 2/3 of an inning, now a complete inning, I guess. He allowed a hit. He allowed 2 walks, allowed the game-winning run to get in scoring position and found a way out of it, man. Just so impressive. Whatever Kenny Barton said, it worked. Whatever Bishop Griggs said, that is, it worked. And the Bucs win. And credit to Logan Hochkopf for helping save this game at shortstop with a great play as well. Again, this was a true team victory. Maybe the most pure team victory we've seen from this squad all season long.
Everybody had a part. That was the story of the game, is this team collectively came together and was able to sneak out of here with the win, because again, it was 4-1 at one point. And the Oilers came storming back, tied it in the bottom of the 8th, and the top of the 9th hit by Jackson Sorensen. Just what clutch is,
yeah,
right there.
Yeah. The media doesn't want you to know this. They don't want you to know this, but the Anchorage Bucs right now, the Anchorage Bucs have now beaten the Oilers 6 out of 7 games they played them and have won 3 in a row to take the series. The Bucs take the series. People won't tell you that.
They also won't tell you there's 2 games over 500 for the first time this season.
Yeah, people aren't talking about it, but they should be. These Anchorage Bucs are really good at the whole baseball thing, and they get to come back and play the Oilers again tomorrow, which kind of makes me happy because 6 out of 7 wins, that's big.
That sounds good. Final score tonight, Bucs 6.
Yeah, we got to get to dinner,
Oilers,
don't we?
Oilers 5. And we'll see you here tomorrow night as the 9-7 Bucs will take on the Oilers in Game 5 of this series. For Drake Toll, I'm Jace Andrews saying peace out, and as always, it's a great day to be a Buc.
It was time to update the bathroom.
But we didn't want to break the bank.
Rebath made it effortless. A Rebath design consultant came to our home and presented us ideas and products in a way that made our decisions simple.
They took away the old, installed the new, and gave us the bathroom
we've always wanted.
Style affordably. Call 1-844-9-REBATH for your free in-home design consultation today.
Of all the reasons we love Alaska, easy isn't one of them. We like a good challenge, but we also love innovative technology that simplifies our busy lives. Whether you want to make a deposit or pay a bill, check in or check out, or quickly send and receive money, one bank has the online and mobile tools to help you through whatever. whatever comes your way. Simple, secure, reliable. Bank on the go. First National Bank, Alaska.
Arby's new Steakhouse Garlic Ribeye Sandwich. Who knew the best thing to come from a steakhouse wouldn't even come from a steakhouse? Arby's did. That's who. Arby's, we have the meat.